On today's show, it doesn't get any better than this. Bob Saget. It's 3 a.m. Tuesday, February 28th, 2017. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. On today's program, we got another great one. Bob Saget is with us. Also, comedy writer Andrew Goldstein and comedians Kristen Buckels and Giulia Rossi. We got a lot of show. Let's get right to it. Joining us from Los Angeles is Bob Saget. You can see him on Fuller House on Netflix. They're taping a brand new season in March. He's on tour getting his next special ready, and he's directing a movie in May called Jake.
Hello, David Feldman, my friend, my hero, my brother, my sister, my wife, my concubine, my I just miss you. I miss you bad. I'm sorry I'm not in studio with you.
And yet I'm in your house. And we have to do this over the phone.
And it's hard to see you because you're under the desk, which is why I love you. And, yeah. So, yeah, the guy that I'm out doing stand-up with my new hour. And so I've been doing, like, two-hour sets, which is more than, you know, you want to give people their money's worth because they really deserve to be entertained, especially nowadays. But, I mean, that's just too long. So and that's something I've never heard from a woman.
Even in Thailand, you've heard too long. And
no, that's true,
right?
Yeah, that in Bangkok. Yeah,
how long did you date too long?
Well, I dated her sister three long, and she was actually too long. So then I dated too long, and too long started to look a little long in the tooth. So I'm going to date one long. Your grandmother is six long, and that's just crazy. The woman can't walk without tripping.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And her great-great-grandfather was Huey Long, which is, yeah. And then there was her, she had a white trash uncle, get off my long.
I think Furlong.
I like Furlong. So long was the so long's the last thing too long said to me. And then let's see what else. What else we got there? Gotta be something else there. Oh, sure. She had another sister that would refuse to get electrolysis. She was Furlong.
That's what I was just gonna. I was gonna say that. I swear to God.
Well, because you're a genius, and I cut you off because
no,
you're
didn't.
Smarter and funnier than me. I just say it first.
Didn't she have a mother named Love You Long? No, okay.
Yes, yes.
No,
she had no sense of time.
So now you won an Oscar.
Tell me everything.
You won an Oscar.
No, I won a student Oscar. Like when Jimmy Kimmel, who was eloquent, and I thought just freaking amazing. Thought he was, I mean, he's a friend, but the hell with that. He was just fantastic. I mean, not the hell with that. Friendship's more important than how good he was at hosting, but I just thought everything he did pretty much hit with his tone, you know? Yeah, I won a student Oscar. So they had student Academy Award winners handing out trophies. I just hope they're not the ones that handed out the double extra envelope that they had of Emma Stone's second envelope, because they had one on either side of the wings, apparently, is what happened. That's the big travesty today. The only thing I loved about the Oscars and the travesty of the wrong envelope and wrong announcement of the wrong winner was it wasn't a political story. It was more of a Hollywood story gone wrong, and no one's really fact-checking. I don't know. Is your show real news or fake news? Or I can't. Is it fake boobs or real boobs? I can't decide. God, I want you to milk me. That's probably a bad aside. It probably is not something I should have just shared off the top of my head. Oh, God.
What did you
I have udders.
You have udders?
Remember when Dana Carvey did that show for ABC? It was so great. And he did a bit where he had a ton of udders squirting milk. He made this whole big prosthetic suit. It was just so good.
He was Bill Clinton.
That's what it was, Bill Clinton, just milking, just being milked, squirting milk.
How many nipples do you have?
12. You know, one for all the days of Christmas. Because there's six maids of milking, and all that, that's two nipples a maid. Mm-hmm. So they can handle that.
You won a student Oscar. It was it a documentary about your nephew?
Yes. Yeah, my nephew had his face. This sounds like a joke because of everything that's led up to this moment. But my nephew had a disorder called Treacher-Collins syndrome, which is his bones were not formed properly, a hereditary thing. And they operated on him and took ribs out of his chest and rebuilt his cheekbones and his ears. And the movie was called Through Adam's Eyes. And it was 11 minutes long. And I was fortunate enough to win. I got it through Temple University. That was my school. I won a Student Academy Award, a Merit Award. There was another guy, John Block, a very brilliant guy. He's done a lot of NBC pieces producing. Used to be Tom Brokaw's major segment investigative reporter, Real News. He won the award ahead of me about a gambler, and it was quite fascinating. But that was my first indoctrination to filmmaking, and I came to LA when I was like 21 and was going to be a filmmaker. Went to USC for 3 days, their grad school, and then decided Mitzi at the Comedy Store said you can work here for free, and I said, okay, good, I'll drop out of college. So I stopped being a filmmaker. I probably would have made 20 films by now. Instead, I've made some movies. I'm going to direct again in May, a movie called Jake that I'm passionate about. And that movie you'll like. It's about a kid who's 15 who the family believes is on crystal meth. So my girlfriend calls an intervention on Facebook, and that's not where you call an intervention. That's not a good idea. So it's a dark comedy, and I'm excited about it. So we'll shoot that in May, June. So I get to get out of director jail again for a little bit. So it's been a while since the last thing I directed, I'm trying to remember what it was. Got to be something after my Penguin movie.
Don't you do martyr videos for ISIS?
Yeah, all of it, all of it. And the last one was called Quit While You're Ahead. And it's very, very strong. And it's all about using the overhead compartment, you know. Uh-huh. You know that Joe Pesci movie was eight heads in a duffel bag or something. Kind of get that philosophy to see if TSA stops you if you got eight heads in a duffel bag. You know? Because according to our regime, presently we're going to get every single ISIS member, which is obviously realistic. There's no way that's not realistic because they're spread all over the world. And they're already infiltrated, already here, and already everywhere. So there's, of course, they're all at one beer hall, but we can get them all.
I'm a member. So I get the screeners for the jihad martyr videos. It's because I vote.
Yeah.
On the jihadis.
The screeners is what they put the screener over the bucket after they cut your head off.
Mm-hmm.
But I came up with merch for ISIS, and I'm pretty excited about it.
Came up with what?
Merch.
Oh, merchandise for ISIS.
Yeah.
It's merchandise.
Yeah. Merchandise. So if they have events where they have, you know, terrible things that they do because, you know, we're not fans. But, you know, merch is merch, you know. And one of the main things I came up with was a T-shirt, but there's no hole for the head. And I think it's going to catch on. It's just... just two arms and a little bit of an abdomen. I'm incredibly upset at where the world's at. Have you been having trouble sleeping? Because I've been texting you late at night, and you have been up. You'll come up with three words to go back to bed. But I, you're a sensitive guy. You're a political guy. You always have been. Have you been upset? I've been having trouble sleeping. Have you been?
I'm worried that our leader will not be able to get his plans implemented.
Right, to be able to get the right host for The Apprentice. Because he's not happy with Arnold, and he's got to make sure, because you know he's got a corporation that's rolling in the dough. So.
I can't figure out if it's me or him, because I've lived through... am I looking for an excuse to have an anxiety attack?
Well, we're all having it, so it can't just be you. All of us are having it, except for the people, you know, the people that support him. And it's understandable. People go, that's my president, and I want to support him. And then there's other people that go, that's not my president. I support America. I love America, but that's not my president. The behavior is disappointing, you know.
Let's focus on the positive.
Let's do that. I agree with you. I agree with you. I think it's wonderful that he's attracted to his daughter. because that shows that he, you know, he really loves her more than just mentally.
There you go. He's a great father. He's a great father.
And can you say that again? I think I went through the canyon.
What?
we could use a great father right now. That's true.
And
you know that to be a great father, it's often that you had one. You know, I had a great father. I have three daughters. The reason I think I'm a really good father, I wouldn't say great, because I haven't done everything perfect, because I'm still me. But is that they're so amazing? They're so beautiful and so smart. And, you know,
and you didn't shield them. You weren't overly protective
I was. Where would you come up with a fallacy like that?
I met some of your daughters and they seem very smart and educated.
Some of my daughters.
Well, I don't want to get into specifics, but they're very worldly and sophisticated and they've seen the world.
They've seen some of the world. They haven't seen a lot. They got back from Cuba. They brought me cigars, so they're good daughters.
But you weren't overly protective of them.
I was sometimes, and I needed to be, because that's the case. They don't. How do they know how to do things, you know? I mean, people are 16. They're making mistakes. We all know nothing good happens after midnight, at my house anyway.
I remember you said that to me. I was having a sit down with my ex-wife at DuPar's at the farmer's market at 1 a.m. And you said to me, nothing good happens at DuPar's at 1 a.m.
No, that's true. You want to be at DuPar's at 11 a.m. when everybody has a script and they're all reading it. And it could even just be like, anything. It could be the Serpico, you know? I mean, it could be a 40-year-old script of a movie, Gone with the Wind, but they want to look like they're working. So they have the script right there. It's really nice. For people that don't know DuPar's, it's the best restaurant in Los Angeles.
Yes, it is.
I didn't mean to cut you off. I cut you off. I'm sorry.
Said my moil.
My moil.
My moil, so I didn't mean to cut you off.
Oh, wow.
Hey, yeah. So when you were...
My baloney has a first name.
Yeah, what's its name?
A Harold.
Have you ever had gay sex? Because we've joked about
well,
it.
Well, I was... No, let me be honest with you. I've had gay sex in the old school terms of the word. I've had very happy sex. As far as the modern day terms where you can also say that gay means homosexual, I have not, but I feel left out, to be honest with you.
Has a man ever thrown himself at you? Because I've been out with you.
Yes, a man has thrown himself at me. One time I was walking through a warehouse and a guy jumped off of a ladder and he threw himself right at me. His zipper was down, and I was able to catch him. His testicles went into my mouth, which prevented his fall. It actually saved his life.
Has a guy ever come on to you? I would assume.
No, because I wear rain gear, so and it's going to be hard for them to. It's not going to be on me because I take off the rain gear and that's that.
You're very polite. You're very kind to your fans. I think of all the people I know, you are the most grateful to your fans.
Well, it took a long time for people not to go, you know, you're that milquetoast Full House, or you're the video show, who writes your jokes? And, you know, it was commercial television, and so there was not a hip quotient, you know? It was family television I was doing, so I didn't disagree with them. But also there's a purpose for it, and cynical people don't see that purpose, but...
I think it's the hardest thing to do. I think the hardest thing to do...
hardest thing for me to do was to do stuff that wasn't my exact comedic voice, which would have been more sarcastic, more hip, more whatever hip. That's, when you say more hip, you want to be more hip. You are more hip means just you're not. You couldn't be... You're a pentagram. But I do love when people are entertained by my work. And now people are more entertained. I'm out doing stand-up, and I'm loving the hell out of it more than ever because it's a brand-new hour. So the tour that I'm doing is strictly to get myself in order for a new special that I'll be really proud of. So I'm hoping that works.
And what is the mood of the crowd right now? Because I've noticed that the crowds have changed. They're all saying, what's up with Feldman's facelift? Have you noticed? No, I didn't get a facelift.
Yeah, they say that to me.
What? But I have noticed the crowd. There is palpable energy out there. Their butt cheeks clench when you mention certain names.
Well, my audience is, I talk a lot about stuff below my waist because I don't do much politics because people suffer enough. And there's enough eloquent people doing it. I mean, John Oliver, Bill Maher, Stephen Colbert, people are really attacking this beautifully. It's so topical and changes moment to moment. I'm working literally on a special, so I wanted the comedy to be more evergreen so that it could be, you could watch it in 5 years and you're not watching, oh, wait a second, he got impeached. He's not our president.
Right.
Or, oh my God, he's the king of the earth. Everything's changed. It could go either way. He could be king of the earth.
How do you fight the temptation to speak out on transitory issues like this? Issues that-
Well, I think a transitory issue, I think everyone should use the same bathroom. I think... this is what I believe. If you are a transgender, and if you are a man, and if you are a woman, and if you are any of the categories that can exist in a human being, everyone should use the same exact toilet at the same time like a totem pole. They should sit on top of each other and between each other's legs to get the work done. And the only thing is, the guy on the bottom, his duty is to just keep flushing because there's a lot of shit.
You said his duty is to keep on flushing?
I did. I did a redundant. And then I went, it was a pun. But I've been hashtagging on most of my sites that puns matter. And I really do believe that. As people put down puns, you know, you'll do a joke, especially if you're doing a tweet.
Let's get back to the important stuff. And I know we only have a few more minutes left, but I'm going to bring up a subject.
Well, no, I'm okay. I'm on life support.
I know, but I'm going to bring up a subject, and I think you're going to cancel the rest of the day, and we're going to go 6 hours on this.
No, because I have a meeting.
I know. But I'm going to bring something up, and you're going to just
I want to come on your show more. We can continue this also at a later date. It'll be fun as hell.
Okay, let me pitch an idea to you.
I'm already bought. Love it.
You like it?
I love it.
Now, this is a money-making idea. Okay. Does anybody enjoy a public restroom? Nobody. Nobody wants to use a public
restroom. I think the people that work there. Because they've been standing behind the counter. If you work at In-N-Out and you get to go into the bathroom, you want to get it out and then go back in.
You and I have spent a lot of time in men's rooms, you know, hanging out. And yes. Nobody's happy. Nobody wants to talk to us. they just...
Well, the one thing you and I do that we can't help, it's almost our own little performance art, is we like to hand out paper towels and spray people with cologne as though they're in a fancy restaurant.
Uh-huh.
And so we do it at a Denny's, we'll do it at a 7-Eleven, and we just stand right outside. Sometimes we just sit there. The guy will go, hey, excuse me, I've got to make number two. And we go, well, we're fine, we'll just stand here. And it's just you and me, just next to each other. And you've got that towel folded over your arm like a really fine waiter when you're about to select your steak. So, I mean, I think that...
We make a little money because you always have a Polaroid camera and you always knock on the door and say, before you flush, would you like a picture with it? Would you like a picture with it? Where you had that?
You're saying a duty selfie?
Yeah, we'll take a picture of you, and it's $5 by the time when you're back at your table.
So you're saying I extend my arm. Let me get this clear. You're saying what we do is that there's a gentleman sitting on a toilet in a rest stop off the side of the freeway.
Mm-hmm.
And he is sitting in that toilet. You and I are both in the bathroom with him. Mm-hmm. He has made number two. And I, after, we tell him not to flush. And I hope no one's eating right now. And I reach out my selfie arm. I'm very strong on the selfie arm. Selfie arm is strong, as Jordan would say. And you're saying I kind of lift the camera up at a high vantage. And I take a picture of myself and you and the guy, and then I ask him to please don't block the actual
the
floating by itself. And we take a picture with the five of us in it. Oh no, it's four of us. Sometimes it's five because he takes him a couple. You know, he I'm going to throw up. I swear to God, I'm going to throw up. But you're saying we take those pictures. That's what you're saying.
Yeah. Like they do at the Stork
Club.
Yeah,
that is.
At the Stork Club, you'd go out, and there would be a lady who would come by, can I take a picture of you? And there'd be a flashbulb that goes off. And in 5 minutes, you'd get a framed copy of that photo. And that's what we do.
Yes, this is
Stucky's.
A velvet framed. Yes, it's an oval velvet framed like you just saw Elvis in Vegas. It is a gorgeous framed memento, and I sign it as well. Because, you know, they're fans of Fuller House, because that's Fuller House starts shooting next month, 18 episodes, third season. And I went right from taking a Polaroid of duty with a man in a 7-Eleven bathroom to plugging Fuller House, a family show meant for everyone.
Before you go, let me pitch you this idea, because you have access to people with capital. You were at the...
I do.
You do. And this is a great investment. Nobody wants to use a public restroom. You know those, like, Johnny Sands at a construction site? Andy Gumps?
Yes.
Right?
Andy Gump. Andy, how do you come up with Gump? I mean, it rhymes with dump. When I see a port-a-torty, I just think of Jackass. I can't think of anything else. I don't know why. Because they went and overturned one.
I always think of a punch bowl. I think, where's a ladle when you need one?
Now, that's actually upsetting because there's chemicals in those things, so people would die. The only way to do it is to tell ISIS that's where the party is. And give them the ladle.
So here's the idea. When you have to do number two, there's an app.
Yes.
There's an app. And you and I, we could do this. It would be like Uber. We would have a car that would tow an Andy Gump. And we'd pull up outside the restaurant or the sporting event. You'd go in to our Andy Gump that's parked outside, do your business, and then you're done. And you don't have to share a restroom with anybody. And then you and I would drive off. And then I know that you learned as a child how to predict the future by reading these things, by, you know, examining.
Yeah, like tea leaves, yeah.
You read people's number two, and then we can figure out how the stock market is going to do based.
Well, you know the invention that retrieves that I invented. It's a part strainer and tong unit, and it's all one unit because mm-hmm. you can't. Does anybody? A lot of people don't like this kind of humor, you know. A lot of people do not. Women, I know, really are offended by poo humor.
I know. Okay.
But you've always enjoyed it. You and I, we're immature. This is immature. This is us being silly because we're dealing with the realities of the world. And sifting through your poo is something that can take your mind off stuff.
Is that the name of your special, Sifting Through Your Poo?
Pretty much it. Where do you see it? You're damn right it is. I'm going to clean it up so somebody can eat a pizza while they're watching. You know? I don't want people to say, I can't eat Bob's specials on.
What is getting a laugh right now, but you just can't do it? You say to yourself, this is funny, it's hysterical, but it's a bad, it's just, I don't want to be known for that.
It's funny. Sometimes I'll come up with something thoughtful or more observational and people don't want to hear it from me. They're expecting something else. You know, they want to hear a combination of irreverence with a piece of truth. As we would say back in the world of poo, a kernel of truth.
You're such a corny comedian.
You know, I am. I have always... Sometimes I get a little flush when I say lines like that, you know. But I just don't remember eating corn. I mean, I have no recollection whatsoever. I don't remember peas, but I don't remember why. I don't know why there's peas in my... Anyway, yeah, there are things that I can't get into a battle as I do at night when I think of the injustices that are going on and the profiling and the racism and then the pain that comes from it. And I think the whole problem is when you incite anger in people and fear, you're creating the problem. So I think those are things that I would like to talk about that I will leave to people that can't help but do it because I want to entertain people. I want to take them out of it. I was talking to the great Norman Lear the other night, and not to name drop, but what the hell else am I going to do? And we were talking, and I said, you know, it's so amazing to be able to take people out of their lives for that 90 minutes mm-hmm. or whatever it is when I do my stand-up. And he goes, you're actually not taking them out. You're putting them into their lives. You're getting them to enjoy an experience as one together. And that is what comedian's job is, whether you're being socially relevant or whether you're just entertaining. We're not just entertaining, it's a pretty significant thing. Or maybe you're shining the light on things. Maybe you're doing some observation that is, you know, you're thinking of what George Carlin would say. A lot of it has become almost prophetic. It's become things that are true and just true for all of us. And where are we with religion? Where are we with where have we gotten ourselves to as a culture at this moment in time with this craziness in our world right now? So my thing is to try to, I have a new song at the end of my show, which is about bringing people together. It's kind of like a We Are the World, but of mm-hmm. course it turns off down little alleys, which deal with all kinds of things that you wouldn't want to hear on the radio.
I'm going to let you go. I thought the subject matter might keep you for another 5 hours, but I want to be respectful.
It might have. It's my number two favorite topic.
I love you, David.
David, I love you.
No, I love you.
A man loves another man in a Turkish prison. You know, I love you like a man loves another man when ISIS captures us both because we're journalists. But because we're fake journalists, they let us live. And they actually put us in a hotel and treat us really good at the palace. And we decide we're disappointed that we didn't get to be in prison and have sex with each other. So we do it in freedom. That's what I wish for us by the end of 2017.
If we were in a cell and ISIS lopped off my head and then they were going...
Hold on, give me one second. Let me just get these pants off. Go ahead.
So they lop off my head, and they're about to lop off your head, but suddenly there's an airstrike, and they got to run for cover, and you're alone in the cell with me decapitated. You would honor my head, right?
I would hold it. I would caress it. I'd shake it and see if at the top of it, it said, try again. No, I would be in horror, to be honest. I can be rational right now. I'd be pretty damn upset.
Bob Saget, thank you so much. We'll talk to you soon.
You're an amazing interviewer. You end on a note of what would I do with your severed head after an airstrike.
And you would use it as an eight ball. You would shake it.
I might.
And it says try again.
That's my suggestion. Yes, so I could read the future. And I would think the future for you at that point is not very good.
Would you ever consider, if this happens, to flip my head right side up, gut the insides, and use it as a pencil holder? Like, put all your pens and clips and...
I thought about it, but the first thing that came to mind would be to hook a strap onto it and use it as a head handbag. So I would have it carved out. It would be, I'd imagine, what cannibals used to do. You know, they would, you know, you use every part of the cow. You know, you use the fur, you use the meat. And I think that's what I would do with your carved out head, David.
When you said you would use a strap-on, I thought you were going into...
No. I get like a purse strap.
Okay.
Leather purse strap.
That sounds
weird
to me.
Formal pocketbook.
That sounds creepy to me. The other kind of strap-on, I thought that makes sense.
I won't do it. Okay, I'll get that one. I'll put that in your mouth, and then that way I won't feel bad.
I love you. Goodbye.
I love you much more. You keep ending on worse notes. I'll see you in New York. I'm there. I'm actually playing Westbury in a couple of weeks, and I'm playing the Count Basie Theater in Jersey, and I'm playing Philly. And I'll be doing Madison Square Garden for a wonderful show of charity for children in need. And I'm very excited to be doing that. And that will be all in the next month or so. So you can see it on my website, which is davidfeldman.com. No, it's bobsaget.com. And that will tell you where you can see the benefits that are coming up and if you want to see my stand-up. And that was my plug after talking about things that would get people to not want to see me live ever.
That's not true. That's not true.
And only you can bring that. There's two things you can draw out in me, and one of them is sick comedy, and the other is the thing that I have, you know, that I use for procreation. Those are the two things you can pull out of me.
Does Westbury still have their sister theater?
Which one is that? That was the Valley Forge Music Fair in Philadelphia area.
I played Dingleberry.
That was a really good place. That was hanging on. Their business was hanging on by a hair. They really had a problem.
I love you. Goodbye.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew Goldstein joins us. He's the co-host of Sorry I've Been So Busy. It's a podcast he does here at the show Briz Studios with Matt Goldich, who is a comedian and a writer for Seth Meyers. And Andrew Goldstein is show running Vidiots. It's a new series on MTV International.
Yes. If you live in any of the 16 markets outside of the U.S. that get MTV starting in March, MTV Vidiots will be resurrecting the music video. It's basically human Beavis and Butthead.
Do you enjoy running a show?
I like being the boss. It's
interesting.
Good. And, you know, it took me a really long time to realize that I have a producer's brain more than I have a writer's brain. I spent 10 years just being a writer, and then that, as you know, leads to producing. And once that started, and I go back and forth, but I really do have a producer's brain. Like when I tried improv in my...
Well, hang on for 1 second, because I didn't know producers actually had brains. So
most don't. No.
Did you stick your head in a microwave?
I did. I just mean in terms of, like, I see order. I see that belongs there, this belongs there, he belongs there, she belongs there, this is how this should go. As opposed to, like, let it organically happen and be fine with it. That's why I sucked at improv, because I would come off the wall and I'd want to produce the scene. And it took me, like, 10, 11 years to realize that's what I was doing.
But how hard is it really to be a producer?
You can fake it. I mean, look, a lot of people do a shitty job and end up very successful. But
what is the talent of a producer? Aren't you just a glorified viewer?
Yes.
You're the eyes and ears and nose of the audience.
And you're the captain of the ship. You're managing your staff, which I love. I know a lot of people don't like that.
Let's go back to being the eyes, ears, and nose of your audience. How hard is that? That means you just sit around, watch TV, and say, I don't like that.
I have a lot of experience. TV did raise me. I was the youngest of three, single mom. So I have a lot of experience watching TV and being like, I like that.
And by single mom, you mean you only had one mom. Your parents were married. You just didn't have
Multiple moms
like I did.
Yes. My dad was a very big part of my life. It was just in the house. There was a mother and the father lived somewhere else. So single mom in quotes. But
single mom could really be heterosexual marriage now.
Yeah.
You can say I was raised by a single mom because I didn't have two mothers. I had a heterosexual.
You have to qualify it now because two mothers is very normal.
Uh-huh.
Two fathers is very normal. So you can't just say single mom. I like that.
That's a whole new way
to think about it. But
and I can gain sympathy when I commit a crime. I can go before a judge and say, you have to have pity on me, Your Honor.
I only had one mom.
I was raised by a single mom.
Give me a break.
That's not lying under oath.
Yeah.
What I meant is, I had one mother. I didn't have two mothers. I wasn't lucky enough to be a lesbian.
These lucky people with two moms? I only had one. Oh, I'm sorry. I only had one mother. Put me in jail.
All right, so back to antagonizing you.
No, I'm into it. Listen.
I just want to...
The two examples...
Being a producer versus being a writer. In the back of your mind, every day that you go to work, you're thinking, I should be writing.
Yeah. I mean, every writer thinks they're better than the performer they're writing for, and every producer thinks they're better than the writers and the talent that they have, that they're employing.
You're a funny guy.
Yes, sir.
You really are. You're the real deal.
Thank you.
I wasn't sure until recently because I haven't seen you.
Well, I just got married, so...
Right. So now you want to be out and about, and that's why I'm seeing you.
No, it's hard to, you know, I have my...
I knew you when you were a sweet page at NBC.
Yes, sir.
And you were kind and excited.
Wide-eyed.
Yeah. But I didn't know if you were funny.
One mom.
I didn't know if you were funny or not.
Yeah.
I kind of knew. I knew you were interested in comedy, but you're really funny. And then I met you at Race Wars again.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, if you're working on Race Wars, you're funny. And then just hanging out with you, you're a funny guy. I mean, you are a genuinely funny guy.
Thank you.
And by my saying you're a funny guy, what I'm really doing is establishing dominance over you.
Yeah.
Because
it's like I'm at the dog park.
Because if I say you're funny, that means I'm an alpha male who determines who's
you're
funny.
You're also implying that you are an expert in
yes,
what is funny,
exactly.
Which I agree with. You're a mentor.
Exactly.
But let me tell you.
So really what I'm doing by saying you're a funny guy is I'm telling my audience I'm important.
I'll say this.
I am a supreme asshole.
Being in all forms of entertainment since the year 2000. That's when I moved to New York and was a page, and everything since then. As being a producer now, I always try to sell myself as I'm a producer with a writer's pedigree because I spent a decade employing myself as a television writer. I've always had trouble working with producers and respecting those producers that don't have a writer's background and try to, you know, give notes. And
do you worry your pedigree is being tainted, that you're going to end up being a mutt?
Is your DNA
being diluted? Do you worry that by becoming a producer, there's going to be a little pit bull in you?
I look at it the other way. I look at it as a strength, whereas I can do both. I can jump in the writer's room and run that room if I need to. And I can have the respect of the people in that room because I've done it, as opposed to producer X who hasn't done it and jumps in the writer's room and starts giving the notes.
This is really interesting. I'm going to stop teasing you, and I'm not even teasing you, but you've just touched on something that I was talking to somebody about last week.
Yeah.
This is really important. And thank you for doing the show.
Of course.
You're
David, when you call, I go through all the other things I have to do first, and then I try to fit you in, especially on Shabbos.
What I love about you is you have to do this. Not comedy, the show, because you owe me money.
I do.
Yeah. No, you have to do this. You were a page because you had to be in show business. As you know, I consider anybody who worked as a page at NBC or CBS to be show business royalty. Because if you work as a page, you know the plumbing. You know the infrastructure of show business. You know what it's all about.
It's a good way to put it.
Yep. And you have to be funny. I've noticed that about you. So I have tremendous respect for you, and I was just teasing you. Here's what you said that's so important, and I want my listeners who are young, and when I say my young listeners, I mean, you know, 55, 60, 65.
Yeah.
most of my listeners are in Del Mar, Florida, going, what? Is that my son?
They're at a diner with a plate of eggs.
This is what the podcast does for most of my listeners. Tell their parents in a nursing home to listen to this show, and they think it's their son calling them.
And they think they're listening to it on the transistor radio.
Uh-huh.
Wait, what were you going to say?
Okay, so I have a lot of young listeners. I don't know why, but I do. And I was talking to a young person who was working for somebody and couldn't get a measure on what the job was, what his role was, and what his responsibility is. And I said, well, what do you do? And he said, well, I'm his partner. Really? Does he pay? You know, well, I guess I'm his partner. Maybe I work for him. Well, does he sign your check? Yes. Oh, then you're not his partner. You work for him.
You're in his employ.
You're in his employ, which means it's a very simple, because we don't talk about money in our culture. But if somebody's writing your check, signing your check, he's the boss. And he's the alpha dog, or she's the alpha dog, the bitch. And you obey the alpha bitch because that's where the money comes from. And there's a militaristic approach to this. When you're in the military, unless you're being asked to do something that is against the law, you follow orders.
Yeah.
Or quit.
A few good men.
Or quit.
Yeah.
And that's how people should go to work. The other thing to understand is that when you show up at work, if you're this CEO of a corporation, you should hang yourself. No, if you're the CEO of a corporation, you're the boss, but you still work for people.
Yes.
There's no such thing as an alpha dog in this world. As Bob Dylan says, you got to serve somebody. Everybody has a boss. Everybody, no matter who you think is at the top of that mountain, they're answering to somebody else. So that when you go in and out of meetings, as you describe, when you're producing and then suddenly you go back into the writing room, you have to flow seamlessly between alpha and beta. There are times in the day when you're the top dog.
Yeah.
But that's momentary. And then 30 minutes later, you're in a meeting with
the chairman of the board, and you're not the you're not the top dog, or you're selling something to another company, and you're not the top dog. And nobody's the top dog.
And so to be able to have that perspective, which I'm lucky enough to have. Look, I never set out to be a producer and a showrunner. All I wanted to do was be in a windowless writer's room, hopefully getting free lunch. Like, that's all I ever set out to do. And so just the fact that I'm in the position I'm in now, I love, you know, to go in the writer's room. I fully understand that my ideas are not the best ideas. Mm-hmm. My jokes are not the best ideas. I'm just part of the team. And then obviously when I leave that room and I have to make a decision or to be on a boring conference call or, you know, hire somebody, all of that, you know, you have to be able to, like you said, go back and forth and have that perspective. I think a lot of people, CEOs, might not have that perspective because they have been on a rocket ship since the, you know, college.
I've seen it with a couple of bosses that I've had, you know, Chris McGuire or Ray James. These were guys who are journeyman showrunners. They go from show to show.
Yeah.
I've worked with them where they're not showrunners, where Chris will hire Ray and Ray will hire Chris. And it's really fascinating. It taught me a lot to watch how they lock in to the role of subordinate. That if Ray hires Chris, Chris just shows up, does his job, doesn't question him, waits till Ray says to him, hey, can you, but just falls in line. And then when Chris hires Ray, Ray falls in line.
So
there's something very militaristic. And it's taught me a lot that when you go to work for somebody, you work for them.
I would bet there's a ton of mutual respect between the two of them. I'm in a similar situation. I hired all my friends.
Yeah, and that's a mistake.
Probably.
It is a mistake.
But they are very talented people.
And, it's a mistake.
And one of them is a showrunner in his own right. But on this particular job, he is just directing. He is just directing the talent. And it's really fascinating to be like, well, technically, by the letter of the law, I'm in charge of you. But like, you're way more experienced as a showrunner than I am. So I'm leaning on you a lot more than you're leaning on me. But one, you know, the next gig, you might be my showrunner. And that's just how it is. And we all accept that and respect that about each other.
Then he's not a friend.
Yeah. No, he's a very close friend.
But I think it's a type of friend. I think.
Well, we were pages together. It's an occupational friend.
Right. Which is different from a real friend.
Yeah.
Because an occupational friend won't stab you in the back, won't complain, won't sit by craft services he's doing it wrong.
Yeah, if I was a dick producer, but I'm a very. Again, I'm new at it. So right now, perhaps there's a. Grace period, but
no. I think what happens is friends, really close friends, who you get drunk with, you hang out with.
Yeah,
you've told them everything about yourself. They've seen you at your worst before you ever work together. Just friends. When you bring them on board, they are the ones who, the minute there's a problem with the show, will complain to your higher ups.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, look.
I can do this a lot better. An occupational friend, somebody who you were a page with, would never do that.
Well, there's a foxhole mentality with those guys. And like,
know that there's going to be another foxhole.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, my best friend, they all work in not entertainment. And if I hired them because of just cronyism, it would be a disaster. But in terms of my little inner circle of occupational friends, TV friends, they're the first, second, third, fourth, fifth phone calls I would make I hire a stranger.
Let's talk about ageism.
Sure.
Ageism.
I have a little ageism in my pants.
I think
right now.
God, my son sent me. Oh, my God. One of my sons.
I make a jizz joke. You bring up your son. This is wonderful.
Well, he was my jizzum once.
Exactly. It's a seamless transition.
I don't know. My kids are fantastic.
I have a kid. I don't want to violate their privacy, but I have a son who's an intellectual, who's now fluent in German, conversational German, reading Heidegger and Marx.
Wow.
But when
you're doing a podcast at the Showbiz Studios.
I know.
I'm kidding.
I know.
It's kidding,
and,
Alex.
And he's living the life that he should be.
Yeah.
I'm very proud of him. When we text back and forth, he is constantly making jism jokes. I mean, it's just like,
But they're very intellectual jism jokes.
I texted him last night and he made me laugh out loud. And it was.
That's got to be great as a dad.
He said and I'm telling you, this guy is as progressive and liberal as Ralph Nader. He's just a miracle.
Right.
And on the right side of history. He said something about I read that article, and now when I see a homeless guy on the street, I no longer blow my wad in my pants. Here's what he did. He says, I was very moved by that. It changed how I see this group of people. And now when I see a homeless guy on the street, I no longer blow my wad in my pants. And I go, ha. And then he types back, now I blow my wad in his face.
I love that that's the relationship you have with your son.
So I write back. You know, he grew up. I gave my kids notes.
Yeah.
I noted my kids to death on their jokes.
That's great.
And I said, yes, that is, I laughed. That was mathematically correct.
Yeah.
Very good. I'm proud of you. But really, is that the best use of your spear to do a joke about blowing your wad in a...
He heightened?
Yeah.
You know. He created a very visceral image
mm-hmm.
in his father's head.
Well, I mean, it was two laughs. One was just the shock his blowing his wad in his pants from seeing a homeless guy. The profanity was shocking enough. But then the tag with he blows it in the guy's face.
He clearly understands comedy having, you know, being raised by you.
But he made it even worse.
Yeah.
But it's a waste of his time. Ageism is the problem.
Singular jism.
You're young. You're just starting out.
Yes.
You're just starting out. Do you think ageism is caused by old people? I'm going to hypothesize that ageism is the fault of old people because they become victims of their own expertise. They can't sit around a table with young people without saying, we did that already.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Would you have trouble?
I wasn't with you on the premise until you gave that example. And I'm like, yeah, that's probably right. That's probably why there's the hesitance to bring an older person into a room of younger people.
Mm-hmm.
It's the get off my lawn. We did it better. Look, I'm however old I am, 38, and I'm obsessed with the fact I can't believe certain pop culture things aren't in the frame of aren't in some people's purview.
Like the kids dancing the Lindy.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the Lindy and the flappers, they're making fools out of themselves.
Yeah.
And when I write jokes about that, nobody gets
My wife, it's weird to say that. We just got married. My wife, we are 8.5 years apart. And I'm I am a pop culture person. So everything is a pop culture reference. And it like blows my mind that if she doesn't understand a Princess Bride reference.
But you can rework those references. I mean,
I've gotten better at not being like amazed, you know, like making her feel dumb
mm-hmm.
when she's like, I don't get what that means when you say master your domain.
She doesn't watch Seinfeld.
She has. But well, now I'm...
But
now,
you shouldn't be quoting Seinfeld. You shouldn't be getting laughs off Seinfeld. Shame on you.
But I wish I had a better... Even like now she... I've gotten her into politics because of everything that's going on. And so certain things will come up during the screaming shows. Certain references will be made. And I'll be like, that is such an interesting point. And then she might not know the reference point.
While you're trying to think, old man.
Yeah. No, but let's go back to your main point. Ageism.
I want to get back to one thing about politics. And I'm not going to talk about politics with you today. I need a breather from politics. That being said, we have a very diffused culture. It's been segmented, and it's going to continue to get segmented. But I think one unifying element is politics. There are only 530 politicians. So if everybody pays attention to politics, comedy will be much easier because we'll know who the fat guy is, who the old guy is, who the moron is. All those. Anyway, go ahead. What were you going to say about
the example when everything went down with General Flynn, somebody was likening it to Oliver North.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, oh, that's such a good point. It's a blah, blah, blah. And she asked me who Oliver North was. And because I've learned through the pop culture sphere conversations that we've had, I was able to be like, well, okay, so here's what happened. As opposed to be like, you don't know who Oliver North is? You don't remember the Iran-Contra affair? Meaning, you know, that's how I used to be. So I've gotten to a better place of being very accepting of the fact that there is a gap there. And so if you take that into the workplace, in my role, I have to be very accepting of my staff, which is mostly millennial.
Yeah, I don't want to attack the millennials. I read an interview with a Professor Snyder from Yale. He has a new book, and I'm going to try to get him on the show. And he was talking about this. It's a problem, and it could be the end, he says, of the republic. The inability for millennials and everybody to have any context, any historical perspective, to remember anything that came before us. What it allows is somebody like Stephen Bannon to use the authoritarian playbook, and people don't know that they're doing what Goebbels did. For example, on the cab ride down here, I busted out laughing. I swear to God, this is true. There was a commercial on WINS, the news station, for Buttafuoco and Associates.
I immediately left.
Uh-huh. Alex, how old are you?
28.
28. I heard a commercial today for Buttafuoco and Associates. It's a law firm.
Does that make you laugh?
Does that make you laugh?
Buttafuoco,
who is that again?
Yeah. Okay. So that would be a perfect example of something that would probably happen with me and my wife, or me and one of my millennial office staff.
Mm-hmm.
And then you kind of, but
what's so interesting?
By the way, Joey Buttafuoco and Amy Fisher, he cheated on his wife with a girl named Amy Fisher, and then that girl, Amy Fisher, came, rang the doorbell, and shot his wife in the face.
And she survived. The
and
wife
she survived.
Saved. And talk like that. Amy Fisher is a
And that wife was Greta Van Susteren. Who now is on MSNBC every night at 6 o'clock.
What people don't know.
It's a hilarious joke if you Google image both names.
Greta Van Susteren covered the OJ trial and her face was crooked.
Yeah.
And I used to write jokes.
Just like her beliefs.
And I used to write jokes. Why is Greta's face out of joint over this? Well, you know, don't get your face out of joint, you know, or that's almost as crooked as Greta Van Susteren's face.
Oh, I mean, so many.
Yeah. And then one day she got it fixed.
But did she?
Yes, she did, kind of. And it was cruel and it was wrong.
Yeah.
But this was the 90s when
you were allowed.
You were allowed.
There was no bullying in the 90s.
Huh?
There was no bullying in the 90s. That label didn't exist.
That was comedy writing.
That was comedy writing.
You were quite...
Nobody tried to get you off of Twitter because of that in the 90s.
And it was wrong.
Yeah. It was, you were the Milo Yiannopoulos of the 90s, David.
We'll get to him in a second. So the fact that nobody knows who Joey Buttafuoco is, that was a hack premise. Joey Buttafuoco.
Yeah, it got destroyed.
It was beyond hack. I remember somebody, oh, Sinead O'Connor went on SNL and ripped up a picture of the Pope.
Yes.
And then the next week, Madonna came on and ripped up a picture of Joey Buttafuoco.
Yeah.
Which was pretty funny.
That was SNL's answer to the controversy.
Yeah. And I remember thinking, wow, Madonna's actually funny. That was really funny.
Yeah.
Nobody knows who Sinead O'Connor is anymore, including Sinead O'Connor.
People, it's, look, dude, Michael Jordan, best basketball player to ever live, iconic, you know, branded person, the whole thing. Now, if you're like 18, you only know him as the crying guy in the meme. Right, Alex? Some kids don't know that he's the greatest basketball player of all time, but if they see his picture, they know that he cried once and it just gets destroyed. He gets destroyed about it on the internet.
I'm going to defend the millennials now for not knowing this stuff.
They have bad parents who didn't tell them who Michael Jordan is.
Nah.
And the effect.
They're victims. Think about what's going on right now, how you're unable to keep up with all this stuff because of the internet, because everybody's a journalist. Everybody has a podcast.
Everyone's an expert, yes.
Everybody has a podcast. Everybody has everything. How do you find out what's going on? There's no way. So if I'm a millennial, and millennials are the ones who buy everything and are into fashion and pop culture. Pop culture exists because of millennials, right?
Always.
They follow what's going on. In order for them to keep up with all this stuff, they have to say, okay, what came before me? There's just no time in the day to learn about what came before me.
Yeah, because there's so much else.
And that serves our corporate overlords.
Because you
can be tricked. You can be tricked if you don't know what happened in the past.
Yeah, a whole new reality can be built and you just accept it.
And you can... If you want to exploit the millennials, you can use old tricks that they don't know about.
But the other side to that is because there are so many mediums that everyone is on, there are these watchdogs all over Twitter that will say, Bannon is basically doing what Goebbels is doing. Here is the proof. Now, people ignore it, but that information is out there. There are those voices. There are many people on Twitter who are watchdogs like that.
Yeah, but there's nothing you can tell.
But you can't force somebody to follow those people and to see the content, the counter content that they are producing and putting out there.
What do you think is going to happen?
Just in general?
Yeah, tonight. Are we going to have sex?
If you play your cards right. I'm a big conspiracy theorist. I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but I love conspiracy theories, and there has to be a shoe that will drop. Every day I wake up being like, which journalist is going to get him?
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to tell you why you're wrong.
That's really honestly, not a premise that goes through my head every morning. I scroll through Twitter and I say, which of these watchdogs is going to get them? And honestly, you know what I think is the answer is going to be some regular person on Reddit or some regular person who somehow gets access to something.
Okay.
Why am I wrong?
I'm going to tell you why you're wrong. I want you to think of a prostitute's vagina.
Why do you think I wasn't thinking of that?
Think of a male prostitute's anus.
Okay.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Think of a prostitute who has five or six partners every day for sex. And how numb.
My eyes are closed.
Think of how numb their vagina, anus, and mouth becomes. Think of a comedy writer whose son texts him a joke about blowing his wad in his pants and how we laugh and think, oh, that's a normal conversation between a father and a son.
Yeah.
Think how we...
There are no rules.
Think how we have accepted that it's okay for a father and his adult son to text back and forth jokes about jizzing on a homeless man's face. And you go, ah, that's harmless, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
At the ages that you're at now.
Donald Trump is not going away because there is no shoe that's going to drop. We are numb to the affronts to our sensibilities. He cannot say or do anything that will shock us, that will be illegal or unconstitutional.
It's like he said during the election, I could run out in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody and people would still vote for me and show up to my rallies.
People need to stop with the wishful thinking.
Right.
Nothing is going to happen. Nothing is going to happen. This is football now, and I hate to use a sports analogy.
I'm about to make one.
But this is a ground game. This is inch by inch. You have to fight him. It's a ground game.
Right.
There are no Hail Mary passes coming. This is every. Yeah.
You're right. If there was a shoe to drop, it would have happened during the election.
They're not going to get him.
They're not
going to
get him.
They're not going
Let
to
me,
get him.
On top of that, I get. We've talked about this the last time I was on your show, but I have a background in.
Right, but let me just point out that the American people are like a prostitute's vagina, mouth, or anus.
We're stretched beyond.
That's.
But anyway.
When you listen to the news, I'm just going to keep interrupting you. So when you listen to the news, the point I'm making, because I'm doing insightful political commentary right here. When you listen to the news, remember that your ears, America, are like the mouth, vagina, and anus.
It's a great hot take, and I like it.
Your ears right now are like the mouth, vagina, and anus of a prostitute with a work ethic.
Yeah.
You have
a good old American hardworking prostitute.
You have heard everything and nothing makes you aroused.
Yeah.
You don't feel it anymore.
The other side
of the point I'm making is the listeners, your ears, eyes, and mouth are like the
ear.
Go ahead.
Last time I was on your show,
yes,
we talked about how I wrote for the WWE.
Yes.
Wrote professional wrestling. There is a practice, a time-honored practice. Basically, the fundamental practice of professional wrestling is selling what is being done to you. Whether you're being punched, kicked, suplexed, you have to sell the pain. You have to sell it has to register, and you have to sell that is happening to you, even though the force of what is happening to you is not legitimate. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
That is called selling. It's the fundamental cog of professional wrestling.
Wow.
There is something in wrestling called the no-sell, which is if I throw a quote-unquote punch at you and you just stand there and smile when it hits you, that's a no-sell, and it's like a big faux pas in wrestling. He no-sold it, right? So a lot of people have been interviewing me or asking me about, like, Trump, WWE, he's been in the ring. Like, what does he take from professional wrestling? Because he's such an orator and he's such an antagonist on the microphone. And I would say it goes way beyond what he does on the microphone.
Slow down. Slow down. I'm not going to interrupt you.
No. I just want to make sure I stay.
I want to make sure that you can relax. This is really important to me. And I just interrupted you to tell you that I'm not going to interrupt you.
Great. The number one, what I say to them, it goes way deeper, what he took from the world of professional wrestling, not just being able to antagonize an audience and draw people into the room with what he's saying on the microphone, whether true or untrue or boastful, whatever, is the no-sell. He took that from wrestling and used it to get where he is.
But it's a faux pas.
Look at everything he's no-sold. Everything that's been thrown his way, he's Teflon.
But that's considered a faux pas in wrestling.
Yeah. But he's using it. He's weaponized it. He's weaponized the no-sell. So,
are there any wrestlers?
Gold Star parent, no-sold it. Taxes, no-sold it. Not mentioning the Holocaust on Holocaust Remembrance Day, no-sold it. Brushed it off his shoulder. There are
McCain.
McCain, no-sold it.
Wow.
It's literally it's clear as day to me because I'm a wrestling fan, but like that is what he's, that's exactly his core philosophy is dust off, you know, brush off, it just brushes off my shoulder.
When did you work for the WWE?
2006.
And you did storylines and you worked
storylines, characters, the whole thing. But I've been a wrestling fan for 30 years.
And Donald Trump wrestled Vince McMahon.
Yes, in a tag, with other people involved, and it was their hair versus their hair. And
is it
Trump won, and he shaved Vince McMahon's head.
Is it fair to say that Donald Trump sometimes takes a break from poring over his intelligence briefings to turn on the TV? I know it's hard to believe, but is it possible that the President of the United States would take a break from reading all the reports that are put on his desk, that he would watch
in
wrestling?
Crayon? Yeah.
You think he
watches
wrestling?
I think on
wrestling?
Monday night he retires alone to the quarters, and he puts on Monday Night Raw because Vince is one of his best friends, and he's got three TVs. He's got Raw on one TV. He's got CNN on the other TV, and he's got Fox News on the third TV.
And he loses himself.
And then he tweets. I don't know if any of that's true, but what I do know
is... Oh, no. Rachel Maddow, the other night, talked about the invasion of Yemen that went poorly.
Yeah.
And he was tweeting. While that was going on, instead of being in the Situation Room,
yeah,
she tracked the tweets versus the timeline of the Navy SEALs going in and attacking.
He was like in the quarters tweeting.
Tweeting about a show that he was going to be on. Promoting a show about Fox News and then correcting it.
Yeah.
So he watches wrestling.
I don't know if he's currently watching wrestling,
but
he has been around it. So, I mean, look, the relationship with Trump and Vince goes back to WrestleMania 5 and 6 when they took place in his properties. So he's been around the business enough, and he's so close with Vince McMahon, who's the architect of all of that world, that I'm that's where he picked it up. He's like, anything you say to me or anything that I say, I'm just being my character.
So the media, the New York Times, the Washington Post, they've been banned from some of the press briefings. Lawyers, the elite, don't know anything about wrestling.
Exactly. And they don't understand that they're dealing with a wrestling heel. All he's saying, when judges are saying, no, you did that wrong, that's illegal, he's a wrestling heel saying, you're illegal. And I'm going to show you why you're illegal. April 25th, in the Coliseum, I'll show you why you're fake news. Mm-hmm. That's all he's doing. He's cutting wrestling promos and he's no-selling the babyface's comeback.
And it's fixed.
Well, apparently, by Russia, who is Vince McMahon. We just figured it out. Anyway, I don't want to go a deep dive into wrestling, but I had to bring that up because that to me, that's the prism through which I see everything, is that he's just standing up there. No, he's just not... None of it registers with him.
Is there a wrestler you can cite who he's
not really
modeled his career after?
When you step in, you have to respect your opponent because they're putting their life in each other's hands because of the physicality. And so the no-sell happens, but it doesn't happen at the rate that, you know, like I said, he's weaponized it. Nobody's ever really done that. Because the no-sell in wrestling undermines the whole thing, which it kind of does also in politics. But right now, he's succeeding because of it.
How frightened should we be?
Pretty frightened if you mix that with what you're saying, with there is no shoe to drop. There is no shoe big enough to make him sell. The only time I've seen him... It's really like I can't even think of a time where something actually was thrown at him and it registered with him and he honestly reacted to it.
Mm-hmm.
The only time in the debate when stupid Ted Cruz made fun of New Yorkers and Trump had that genuine moment where he was like, wait a second. I was here. I was in New York on 9/11 with the great firefighters. And
that wasn't a genuine moment.
No, I know. He was using it for politics. But that was the only time I was like, well, there's kind of empathy there.
No, I don't think so. There's that interview with him on 9/11 saying, now I have the tallest building in New York.
This is true. I don't know. Like I said, it's all just, I just have to, for me to be mentally healthy, I have to wake up every morning thinking there's a young Woodward and Bernstein out there that is feverishly going through meeting with sources in parking garages and finding his taxes. And
there's something that Trump and his surrounding, something his people understand that Americans, I think, don't understand about Woodward and Bernstein. It was the deep state that brought Nixon down. Mark Felt, I don't know if I mentioned this on the show or not. I know we were running long and I may have cut this element, but I wanted the audience to know this. What brought down Nixon was what's going on right now. Rogue elements of the FBI and the CIA leaking things to the New York Times and the Washington Post.
Right.
Deep Throat was a guy named Mark Felt.
Yes.
He was second in command at the FBI. I think he had Clyde Tolson's job. Clyde Tolson was J. Edgar Hoover's lover. They shared a life together, and they had a really twisted romantic relationship. Clyde Tolson was number two. By that, I mean he was a bottom.
Yeah.
The number two. And when J. Edgar Hoover died, Mark Felt became second in command and did not like Nixon and had an axe to grind and began leaking stuff to Woodward.
Right. This is all the backstory. This is fascinating.
And was confirming a lot of information. The FBI is a spy agency. They tap phones.
Yeah.
They leak. They wiretap. They wiretapped Martin Luther King.
Mm-hmm.
J. Edgar Hoover had tapes of Martin Luther King having sex. He didn't need to prosecute Martin Luther King. He just sent those tapes to
blackmail.
He was a blackmail. Back then, they weren't called African Americans.
Yes.
Those tapes and photographs of Martin Luther King having sex were sent to Coretta, his wife. There's no need for a trial.
Right.
The FBI literally told Martin Luther King to kill himself. Could you survive that? I couldn't. That's the deep, dark state. Mark Felt, who we consider to be a hero in America because he leaked to Bob Woodward, Mark Felt had to be pardoned by Ronald Reagan. Because Mark Felt, when he was at the FBI, got caught breaking into anti-war protesters' homes and doing illegal wiretapping.
They were paid protesters.
Yeah, of course, paid protesters. Mark Felt, Deep Throat,
yeah,
was convicted of violating the constitutional rights of anti-war protesters. So it's a Faustian bargain when you say, okay, we're going to have the FBI take out Trump. It's a fact because they're not on the side of
right.
the American people. These are spy agencies with axes to grind that we don't understand.
Yeah.
So the reason I'm optimistic is this. Trump is ruining lives. That's why I'm optimistic. No, he is ruining the lives of people. He's ruining...
For sure.
If you're Arab, if you are a Muslim.
If you even look Arab, Look at that story that's in the news now with the Indian kid that got beat up because they thought he was a Muslim.
This is how I'm optimistic. As long as I'm not affected by Trump's policies.
Yeah, as white guys.
But I'm a Jew.
True. Oh, I got something to tell you.
So the only optimism I have right now at this moment, and I don't mean to scare the listeners, but I had an anxiety attack last night. I tried to do a digital detox, and I just got anxious. So I had to go back and start.
See what you missed.
And I had a genuine anxiety attack because I felt weak and vulnerable about what's going on with Trump.
So where does the optimism come in?
And I had to work this out. Germany and Japan are pretty good right now. And the reason they're pretty good right now is they were completely leveled. They were horrible countries. America leveled them. And they
had to start over.
They started over and they learned from their past and they don't seem to be repeating a lot of those mistakes. My hope is Donald Trump is a wrecking ball. What he's doing right now, going after every institution. I mean, the guy.
Well, that's Bannon said it at CPAC. He said he wants to take all the agencies. He wants to deconstruct.
There is some value to somebody coming in, maybe, I have a feeling a lot of lives are going to be destroyed, and this is what making me very anxious. But 20 years from now, the best case scenario is it's post-Trump.
Right.
The same way we look at World War II, what came after Trump. And what he is doing, the ball's on this guy to attack the FBI, to attack the CIA, to make statements that the war in Iraq was a mistake and that the CIA cherry-picked intelligence. That is as bold a statement as you and I can make for a president to say that.
We'll learn some lessons as a country.
If he can do this in a way where Mexicans, and it's not happening. I mean, they have ICE now on the subways rounding up people. It's bad. Yeah. It's really bad.
Yeah.
And it makes me really angry at Jews because 80% of us in America know it's bad. But there's this element, this 20% that says, well, it's okay because Jared Kushner's Jewish and Ivanka.
No. That's where I really get.
I get really.
That's really. I get so angry, and that's what the thing that popped into my head. On I've been doing this thing on Twitter. Whenever I see any story about the Trump White House, you know, not recognizing the Jewish part of the Holocaust, or you know, the vandalism, not recognizing the vandalism that's going on and being part of the alt-right, any of these stories, I will quote tweet it, and I will write, and then with the tweet, I will write, cool, I write, cool tribute to your grandparents at Jared Kushner. Mm-hmm. I've done it about 10, 11 times already.
Right.
And I will continue to do it.
Well, instruct my listeners to do that. The Jewish listeners tell
me. So anytime you see any story about the alt-right and their connection and their being allowed in the political process because of the Trump White House or, you know, his surrogates not recognizing the anti-Semitism that has grown because of his being elected to the presidency. Any of these articles that get posted, quote tweet it and just write cool tribute to your grandparents at Jared Kushner and at him.
And we follow each other on Twitter, you and
yes,
I.
Yes, at Ange Gold, A-N-G-E-G-O-L-D.
And say that again, clearly.
At Ange Gold, A-N-G-E-G-O-L-D.
I am trying to learn Twitter. I'm better on Facebook, and I get more responses on Facebook than on Twitter.
Yeah.
But here's one of the things I want to say to the listeners. Some of you have been tweeting at Bill Kristol, and you include me in the tweet. So I retweet it. I retweet it,
right.
Not retreat. So, for example, I asked people to follow Sleeping Giants on Twitter, which exposes people who advertise on Breitbart News. And
oh, I didn't know that.
And they are shamed into pulling their ads from Breitbart News. It's called Sleeping Giants.
Oh, I got to do that.
Mm-hmm. So if you see a tweet on Sleeping Giants that's shaming an advertiser on
– you retweet it.
Breitbart, include my name in that and I will retweet it so I know. A lot of you have been going after Bill Kristol. I don't want to talk about Bill Kristol, but when you include –
loved him in City Slickers.
Uh-huh. When you – if you include my name, as some of you have been doing, I will retweet it. And what are you saying now?
I say – I just take anything that has to do with, like I said, the alt-right or anti-Semitism as it relates to the to Trump, and I quote tweet it, which is a function. If you press the retweet button, it will say quote tweet. That means that story will appear in your tweet, and there will be a line above it with your message in relation to that. And I write cool tribute to your grandparents, and then I at Jared Kushner. Mm-hmm. So I hope if I do this enough, at some point he's at late at night scrolling through his at messages and sees this. And it just gives him a little rumble in whatever soul he has left that he feels – maybe he feels bad. I would hope that he would feel bad because his grandparents were Holocaust survivors. He went to yeshiva. He's a religious Jew. He raises his kids Jewish, and I just don't – He obeys the Sabbath. I just don't understand where the disconnect is, where he's able to open party to everything that's happening in his family, not just his government and his country, but in his family.
Well, he – just because you're the child of a Holocaust survivor doesn't mean you have instant nobility.
Sure.
Doesn't mean you have instant grace. It is kind of like, you don't have grace. You don't have, and many, I grew up around Holocaust survivors. They didn't start out as Holocaust survivors, but when my parents moved in, it was pretty bad. It became a Holocaust. Yeah. No, I grew up around Holocaust survivors, and they are victims. The children and grandchildren of Holocaust survivors have deep psychological problems that are traced back to the Holocaust. I kind of feel bad that I've made jokes about the Holocaust on this show. I have a gallows humor about the Holocaust.
I have on this podcast.
Yeah, and it's how...
Like Milo, gallows humor.
Yeah.
Kidding.
So, and this is... And Jared Kushner comes from Dreck.
Yeah.
He's Dreck. His father did time.
Super criminal.
His father did time because he wrote checks. He pretty much wrote checks in his son's name to Jersey politicians like McGreevy. The genius Jared Kushner was off at Harvard. Being a genius, right? Meanwhile, his trust fund was being diluted by his father because his father decided to make illegal contributions to Democratic politicians. And then his brother-in-law, Jared's father's brother-in-law, decided to turn state's evidence. So Jared's father hired a prostitute, paid a hooker $10,000 to videotape him having sex so that he could blackmail his sister or whatever.
It's very, yeah.
And he ended up doing time. So Jared Kushner comes from crap.
But I would think at some human level.
But you're projecting your humanity onto a disgraceful human being.
100%.
That he would marry into the Trump family?
But then how, I don't know, but I just, if he's a Shabbos observant and went to yeshiva, like I just know what value system he comes from.
First of all, the Sabbath is sacred, but it's a gift to yourself, not to the universe. It's you turning.
It's less about that. And it's just that I know the value system regardless of his family, but the value system that he was, his formidable years were, I can't wrap my head around him being a scumbag.
He's a scumbag.
That much of a scumbag.
Oh, he's a scumbag.
To be in meetings where somebody is suggesting to Trump and his surrogates not to mention Jews in this message about Holocaust Remembrance Day. He doesn't raise his hand.
In the immortal words of Maxine Waters, my old congressperson from L.A., he's a scumbag.
Yeah.
Thank you, Maxine, for calling these people scumbags. Yeah. They are. She was on television. She called them scumbags. He is arrogant to think that he can control Bannon. He's arrogant to think he can control it. The Jews who have said to me, it's going to be okay for the Jews because Jared.
Oh, I don't think that.
I know. But I don't even think it's 20%. I think 20% of American Jews voted for Trump.
Yeah.
Because of Israel. I doubt it's 20% who think this anti-Semitism is limited and that the anti-Muslim stuff is cool. I know that the Orthodox Jews who tend to vote for Trump are really pissed off about the Muslim ban. For what I have said to the few Jews I talk to who support Trump and say to me, it'll be okay for the Jews because of Jared Kushner, I say, who cares?
Just because it might be okay for your little sliver of your life, it's not okay for a million other people.
Right.
And Jewish values should direct you towards empathy for everybody.
Right.
That's where that's the conflict for me.
Right.
Like, this guy grew up with all of that and still purports to observe all of that.
Well, the reason I take pride.
Umbrage?
The reason I'm not a self-hating Jew is I look at the numbers as a Jew. We love numbers.
We love numbers.
And I say, you know, 80% of a religion that voted for Barack Obama, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
I'll belong to any religion where 80% voted for Barack Obama.
Can I make a transition now that you brought up Obama to an amazing episode of my podcast that we just had that I think you
yes.
will be very interested
I
in?
I want to talk about your podcast in a second. I just want to stay on one topic for 1 second. The people who are listening right now, your ears are like the vagina and anus
of a well-experienced
prostitute.
Yeah.
A hooker with a work ethic.
A grizzled veteran. A journeyman.
We're going to sell Eustachian tube rejuvenation on the show. You know how they have vaginal rejuvenation?
That'd be a good sponsor for you.
Eustachian tube. Is the Eustachian tube the ear hole?
Larry Eustachian?
Isn't the ear hole your Eustachian?
Quite possibly could be.
We're gonna find a doctor who can do Eustachian tube rejuvenation so that you can still feel the garbage coming at you on this show.
It's a public service you're providing.
It is. I have divided Americans into three categories right now. Since Trump.
Fat?
What do you think they are?
Obese? No, you let me know.
Okay. I think there are three types of Americans right now, and we all fall into one of these categories. We are either criminally insane, immoral, or stupid. If you're an American, you are either criminally insane, immoral, or stupid. And I will accept you if you exhibit one of those categories. So if you're crazy, you can be my friend. If you're immoral, you can be my friend. If you're stupid, you can be my friend. But if you're two of those categories, you need to self-harm.
Right. I would add the fourth one as morbidly obese.
I think one of the reasons we have an obesity problem is
because of a few of those.
Because of stupidity, and the craziness, and immorality. I think all problems stem from either being crazy, immoral, or stupid.
Well, that's different than saying all Americans are one of those.
No, all Americans are.
I really think so.
Okay, I think.
What about?
I'm crazy. I'm crazy. You're stupid.
Yeah. Completely. What about like super woke people like Jon Stewart?
Immoral.
He's an immoral guy.
Yes.
With his animal charity farm upstate.
The way he fought the Writers Guild was immoral.
Okay.
Crazy.
Bernie Sanders.
Hang on for 1 second. Crazy, immoral, stupid is a new game. Fuck, marry, kill?
Yeah. Crazy, immoral, stupid.
Okay.
But Bernie Sanders.
I would say crazy.
For thinking he had a chance to win.
Yes.
Yeah. Interesting. This is not a plug of my podcast.
Okay, well, one more. Give me another example.
Let me think. Who else is super? Elizabeth Warren. She's not stupid. She seems to not be immoral.
Busted. You found the chink.
So what
in
is
my
she?
You found.
But we never know. Because there could be some dark side to her that we don't know about.
I'm busted.
She's probably a freak in the sheets, woman on the street. Mm. Probably.
I hear Ivanka.
And yet she persisted.
Ivanka.
In the bedroom.
Ivanka is a freak in the sheets.
Oh, of course.
When she goes to those rallies that the KKK holds, she's a freak in the sheets. It's because I'm making a KKK joke.
Right. She should add two more Ks to her first name.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Okay.
Instead of taking Kushner's last name, she's just adding two more K's to her first name.
Did your wife take your name?
She's in the process of trying it.
Goldstein.
Stein, yeah.
I asked my wife to take my name so I could no longer have it.
Yeah.
Feldman.
I don't want it anymore.
My father told me to take her name. He said, your life will be a lot easier if you get rid of the Feldman. And I said, I don't want to live in a country where I have to change my name.
She is, I get emails from Jamie Goldstein, and I'm like, who is that? And then I have to remember that.
Is your wife Jewish?
Yes.
Do you get tired of having a last name Goldstein? I walk into
a room. No, it's super Jewy.
I am tired that you have a name Goldstein.
You're tired of me having that name.
Wouldn't your life be easier if your Judaism didn't precede you?
Maybe, but I like that people know right away that I'm going to come in and be
Jew up the place.
Jew it up. Yeah,
you do.
I lean into all of that. I do. You get some perks because of it.
What are the perks?
I lean in. People automatically. People will put up with a lot more neuroses from you if you have the name Goldstein than if your name was Johnson.
Doesn't that foster the stereotype that we're insane?
But I don't think it's that terrible of a stereotype.
To be neurotic?
Well, I will pass off some like things that might not be a habit that I just happen to have done, and people are like, that's weird. And I'm like, I'm a neurotic Jew. And you kind of get away. It's like a get out of jail free card.
But that's lazy. That's wrong. It's immoral.
Well, I'm not saying I'm not.
That's immoral, and I think it's stupid and crazy. That falls under all
three. I'm all three.
You're all three.
So during the course of this podcast, you've learned to hate me.
Well, no, I'm not. No. Believe me, before the podcast started, I knew that.
Deep-seated.
To encourage that stereotype that all Jews are neurotic.
I don't think it's a deeply harmful stereotype.
I think stereotypes
I'm not picking up pennies. And, you know, like that, those kind of, like to me, those are, but I lean into the neurotic thing to sort of get out of explaining why I do some weird things.
Are all stereotypes dangerous? I think they probably are. I think it's lazy to.
Our whole medium is built on stereotypes.
Because
without stereotypes, there is no comedy.
Because we're.
So how can you not lean into stereotypes and appreciate
but
them.
Ethnic stereotypes are dangerous.
I'll
give you an example.
Hypersensitivity to ethnic stereotypes is far more dangerous than ethnic stereotypes.
Okay. Because we're living in
a material world.
Yes. Because we're living in dangerous times, we should all be a little paranoid. And last week I was at the Writers Guild Awards. We were going to have Bonnie Dett here, but She canceled.
I have an anecdote.
So I was sitting at the Writers Guild Awards, which is very political. And just reading the names of who was nominated, counting the Jewish names.
It read like a who's who of synagogue men's clubs.
It's not a Jew's who.
Yeah.
It's not a Jew's who. And this is why I think the stereotype of the Jewish comedy writer is dangerous. Because I've lived with the stereotype that Jews are funny and that Hollywood is run by Jews and the comedy writing business is run by Jews. And I have fostered that on Triumph when we were nominated for an Emmy. We went to the Emmys and we had this bit where Triumph was getting out of the limousine with his 20 writers and they were all bald Jews. And we made up Jewish names.
Great.
And we laughed we laughed hysterically. It was really funny. We ended up pulling it from the show. We cast 20 bald Jewish men, put them in tuxedos, and with trick photography, we had 20 bald Jews coming out of the limousine. And it was, I mean, we laughed so hard. And we made up all these names.
I love it.
You know, Andrew Goldstein, and then we had the self-hating Jews.
Isidore Schwartz.
But right, and then we had the guys who were like, Milton Roosevelt Ziff.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's neither here nor there. So I'm at the Writers Guild Awards, and the subtext of this is...
You were nominated for a Writers Guild Award.
Yes.
And you won.
Yes.
This is the anecdote I have, so I have to get this out.
I know that there needs to be diversity in Hollywood.
Yeah.
But I also know that one of the cliches is it's run by Jews. And what that does is it makes it harder for people who are Jewish to find work in Hollywood. And when people say that to me, when I say that to people, they go, what are you talking about? It's run by Jews. And I've heard Jews say that. And I say, you want to crunch the numbers?
Right.
I'm all for diversity, and I think there's a problem with a serious problem with diversity in Hollywood. But all stereotypes are dangerous. And I went through all the names. There are most of the names are not Jewish. Is Weisberg a Jewish name? No. Is Wiener a Jewish name? No.
It's an embarrassing one, but it's
is
not.
Meckelberg a Jewish name?
Schmeckelberg.
No.
Can I tell you something?
But seriously, if you look...
It's an interesting point.
If you look at original screenplay, Hell or High Water, written by Taylor Sheridan, La La Land, written by Damien Chazelle, Loving, written by Jeff Nichols, Manchester by the Sea, written by Kenneth Lonergan, Moonlight, Barry Jenkins...
These are net
Arrival.
But these aren't comedies.
Well, hang on. Deadpool, written by Rhett Reese, and
he could be Jewish.
Shlumi Shlemachl.
He could be Jewish. See, the only movie with any
Nocturnal Animals, written by Tom Ford. Hidden Figures, Alison Schroeder.
The only
Fences, written by August Wilson. Was August Wilson? I always forget. Was he Jewish?
The only movie there with any personality was written by the Jewish people.
Well, it's dangerous to spread this. Okay, comedy. Let's look at comedy.
Can I just tell you really
quick?
Hang on
for 1 second.
Matt Goldich, my podcast partner.
Daily Show with Trevor Noah. Dan Amira, David Angelo, Steve Bodo, Devin Delaquante.
That's my buddy. We used to share an office.
Who?
Devin Delaquante.
Is he Jewish?
No, he is not.
Zach DeLonzo, Trayvon Free, Hallie Hagland. David Kabuka, Matt Koff, Adam Lowe, and I think Adam is Jewish.
Lowe's Jewish.
Alex
Marino. Plays the Jew on The Daily Show.
Dan McCoy, Lauren Sarver Means, Trevor Noah, Joe Arpaio? Sheriff Joe Arpaio writes for The Daily Show?
He does. They hired him.
Daniel Radish sounds like a Jewish name. Michelle Wolf sounds like a Jewish name. Delaney Yeager. I mean, the idea that the Jewish comedy writers, it's
We're very oppressed now, even in our own thing.
Well, that's why they're dangerous. All those things are dangerous because it affects your ability to earn a living.
I haven't experienced that yet.
Well, you will after the show.
I'm sure I will. Wait,
you will.
I need to tell you, at the WGA Awards, I was not there, but Matt Golich was. He's my podcast partner, writer for Seth Meyers. And he came back and told me that when the Triumph Special won the award... Mm-hmm. Robert Smigel, in his acceptance speech, threw you a very, very generous compliment that happened to be super hilarious and backhanded. Robert Smigel apparently said, he shouted you out. He's David Feldman. He's the best comedian nobody likes.
Yes, that
and
is
so
true.
Golich, he thought that was such a fantastic joke, and we talked about it on our podcast. Sorry, I've been so busy, but I thought it was a very funny joke for somebody you spend a lot of time with.
Yeah, he said, Andy Breckman, the creator of Monk, Michael Komen, creator of Nathan For You, and Josh Comer's a brilliant comic, and David Feldman, the greatest comic nobody likes. And I heard greatest comic. I thought, oh, this is going to be good.
Right. And you didn't even hear the other part. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
But speaking of our podcast, I really do. This is really why one of the reasons I came. And this is not me coming on to plug our podcast. But this week.
Is it done out of the Showbiz Studios?
Yes.
So it's part of the Showbiz
family. It's part of the family.
I think we've plugged
you. We're Mishpucha here.
We've plugged your show on this podcast.
And this is an episode I would like you to plug because I think it's special. We had... a girl named, a very talented woman, I should say, who I used to work with at MTV. Her name is Sierra Lindsay Koss. She's on our show. She left entertainment.
What is the name of your show?
Sorry, I've been so busy.
No, I want to know the name of your show.
Sorry, I've been so busy. The podcast.
Okay.
So the real quick story, 8 years ago, we were sharing an office at MTV, and I say, Sierra, what do you want to do? Where do you want to go from here? And she said, I'd like to do what I'm doing, like docu-producing TV, producing content, but in politics. And I said, okay, good luck with that. I'm going to go work for wrestling. Next thing I know, I look on Facebook, and she is producing and directing for the Obama 2012 campaign. And then she moves on from that to Hillary's 2016 campaign, becomes director of video for Hillary 2016. So for 8 years, she was knocking on doors, then in a video and directing capacity for Obama, and then in a leadership video capacity for the Hillary Clinton campaign. And so everything that has happened since, she came on the podcast, and man, did she tell some amazing stories about flying on Air Force One, being in the motorcade, having a daily personal relationship with President Obama, working with him on a daily basis, being in his company, and then the same with Hillary Clinton.
I heard he hits.
Wonderful.
He hits, right?
Yeah. Completely, very abusive. Wonderful, wonderful perspective, and one of the great this is a spoiler alert, but one of the really eye opening things that she says at the end of the podcast, she said the thing she feels most regret about the whole thing everything that has happened is that America quite possibly missed out on an excellent, possibly all time greatest president. But getting
Bernie Sanders?
Yes. But getting there.
She's talking about Hillary.
It was just a wonderful hour of discussion of here. Yes, she was talking about Hillary. And she had the stories and the anecdotes and the personal experience with her to back that up. It's not just some pundit on TV saying that as a talking point. And it was just wonderful, wonderful perspective in these times to hear about these people that have been in office and have shaped policy. And she was right there along for the ride for all of it. It was really, obviously we interview comedians and writers and producers and really, entertainment people, but we had her on and it was really excellent, and I'm very proud of it and I'm proud of her, and I would love people to listen to it. It sounds like a plug, but it's
a plug. What's wrong with
only
plugging?
Because you're the king of plugs.
Do not bring up my hair transplants.
It's I only say it because I was just sitting here. I mean, Alex can attest. We were just like, I wish this could go two more hours because I have a million more questions. And she was, you know, obviously election night was not something we really got into because she's still sort of despondent about mm-hmm. it. But hearing about like what she did after the election to sort of get away and, you know, detox like you were talking about. It was just fascinating. What a fascinating turn she took in her life, and imagine 8 years with no days off. In it, she was in it, and I was super. I just admire her so much because I look at it like if I took anything really seriously, like if I could do it all over again and really like took things seriously and didn't watch as much TV, I would love to have been a speechwriter. I really feel like I could have been, I could excel at that. And so like
they have training program.
I would love it.
I worked with a writer named Eli Bauman. Do you know Eli? He's a musician writer. And he was off, he's a young kid, and he was off at the DNC this past summer.
Really?
Being trained to write speeches. It's a skill. I mean, you just don't do it overnight.
No, of course. But anyway, it's just one of those things. I just wanted to get the word out about
it. What is she doing now?
She is consulting for a number of people that are involved in policy.
And she's going to be rich. Like
we don't know. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of money.
I'll tell you what. She could write a book and it'd be
she can write a book.
Phenomenal.
Yeah. You know, I've been crunching numbers. I had Mike Murphy on the show.
I love Mike. I got to tell you, he is one of those. If I hear he's going to be on one of the shows, I perk up.
Yeah, he's brilliant. Republican strategist, but part of the left-right alliance. Yeah. You should let it's last.
He reminds me of a character on The West Wing. He reminds. Yeah. Yeah.
His heart's in the right place. His politics are in the wrong place. He should come to our side. He ran Right to Rise. It was the Jeb Bush super PAC. They had $100 million. By the end of Bush's campaign, they had $14 million left. All that money gets spent. And when you crunch the numbers, if you want to make money, go into politics.
Right.
That's where the money is. It really is.
Well,
that is what's wrong with Washington, D.C.
Of course. Citizens United.
There's a lot of money.
Yeah.
And people need money.
Well, there's also a lot of money in outrage. There's also a lot of money in being offended now. There's also there's a lot of money in being contrarian. And we're seeing that all over cable news. There's all kinds of money now not being an important person, being a commenter on important people.
Right. Keep the argument going.
Yeah.
Keep the argument going so that journalists don't have to do real reporting.
Yeah. And look, I spend hours watching MSNBC.
Why?
Here's
what happened with me. I take pride in not watching CNN or MSNBC. I listen to Rachel Maddow as a podcast. I will occasionally listen to Anderson Cooper as a podcast.
Coop?
The Coop. I'll do it audio. But to plop down and sit in front of a TV and watch that is a waste of time.
Well, I like the Chris Matthews.
I like Chris Matthews, but to sit and watch that, if I'm doing something, if I'm doing the dishes.
I like the spittle in the sides of his mm-hmm. mouth, so. You don't get that on the podcast.
If I'm going for a walk or going for a drive, a podcast version of these shows is fine. I'll even enjoy Morning Joe as long as I don't have to watch
He's an interesting character.
He's an interesting character. But to sit and watch that stuff is just a complete waste of time.
You like the Mika Brzezinski?
I have a tape of her. I do, on my website, of her talking about how you should beat your children.
Oh, goodness.
Because the big new Brzezinski, the national security advisor under Jimmy Carter, he and his wife used to beat the kids. And I have a tape of her talking about this on Morning Joe. She's the victim of child abuse. And she, on that show, is a willing victim of abuse. If you see the way Joe treats her,
right,
he really manipulates
her. He has
her.
An audience with Donald Trump. He's a very interesting character.
It's a perverse show. There's a perversity to it. The dynamic between Joe and Mika is really salacious. He's much smarter than she is. She is an abuse victim. And if you go to my website, I have the tape of her talking about how she was beaten as a kid. And sometimes it's important to give your kid a good smack. And they're all laughing. And then when you watch how she falls in and out of favor around that panel, how she's lifted up and then taken down by Joe, who is right. a Republican.
Yeah, I remember when I was a kid, he was a politician.
He's pretty smart and emotionally manipulative, and supposedly they're an item. So watching it, I have to confess that there is something interesting.
Is she a conservative?
No, I think she's an abuse victim. I know she's an abuse victim. Her parents abused her.
They're not like, if they're an item, they're not like James Carville and Marley Matlin, right?
They're, from what I've read and from what I've heard, they're in a relationship now.
Interesting.
I don't know if it's, you know,
who's on deck? Who's in the minor leagues that we can be excited about?
In terms of?
Democratic politicians. And it doesn't have to be a politician. It could be somebody who, like the Mark Cuban rumors. Like who's the guy, like if you had to put all your chips on somebody?
I don't even know if we have any chips left.
Yeah.
I read this interview.
Well, today's the DNC chairman vote.
I read this interview with this professor, Snyder from Yale, talking about our republic. He says might have 9 months left.
Not just the party, but the whole.
Where we just acknowledge pretty much what's already happened. This is what he says, that this country is not a republic. It's not a democracy. Obama put a nice face to a bureaucracy that was run by the military-industrial complex and corporations. He was putting a happy face to some really dark stuff.
I would love for you to have Jesse Ventura on your podcast somehow.
I don't. No. Navy SEAL.
Navy SEAL. A patriot.
Governor of Minnesota.
He does work for RT. I will say that. It's
the Russian television.
Yeah.
Well,
but
should we take a break? Yeah. Have we done a half hour yet? This went by. Oh, who we have? Is Buckels here?
Yeah, she's on.
This is the podcast, The David Feldman Show, and my podcast. Sorry, I've been so busy. And check out the Sierra Lindsay Koss episode. I can't promote it. I can't explain enough how wonderful it was.
Can you stick around?
Let me check my text messages from the wife, and we'll see.
Before you were married, we were out every night.
Here.
We were
with these train grizzled professional prostitutes, just loosely having sex with them.
It was amazing.
Multiple phalluses could fit in any.
Mm-hmm. We'll be back, hopefully, with Buckels and Andrew Goldstein after this. Are we rolling?
Alex, are we rolling?
Are we rolling?
Are we rolling? Is this live?
Are we rolling? We're not rolling yet.
That's our
So.
I've noticed that I've been here like 4 times now, and 2 times I've been sick, so it's a sign.
Who are you?
Jesus Christ.
Hello, Jesus.
Bye.
Andrew Goldstein, you have any apologies for Jesus?
No. None.
No apologies.
Kristen Buckels is here. We love Kristen Buckels. She's so funny. She's a comedian and a writer and mm-hmm. a producer.
True.
And what is Jax?
Jax is a production company that produces everything that's awesome right now.
She's not even kidding.
I'm not even exaggerating.
Like what?
Inside Amy Schumer, Broad City, Younger, Search Party, to name a few.
Wow. Good for you. So you're working for them.
Yeah. I start March 13th.
Can I pitch an idea for a show?
Please don't.
It's two bald Jews living together, trying to make it in New York, sharing one toupee.
Sharing one toupee?
Yeah, they can only afford it one toupee. And it's like the Odd Couple, but
I was going to say, is this
one of them gets to be bald and one of them gets to have a full head of hair.
It's mm-hmm. called Toupee and a Half Men.
There you go.
There you go. Is Charlie Sheen in it? Is he making a reprise role?
I'm serious. Why don't they make a great sitcom? Two guys. They're both bald. They're trying to make it in show business.
Toupee Broke Girls.
And they can only afford one toupee.
Yeah, that's funny.
I have a date tonight.
You don't have a date tonight.
I have an audition. I need the toupee for my audition for The Death of a Salesman. They're bringing. So it's all the complications.
And hilarity ensues.
Sure. Well, yeah. Okay, here's the deal.
Okay.
You take it to Sardi's.
Thank you so much, Mr. Feldman, for your idea.
You can have the toupee. You wear the toupee at dinner.
Then you're gonna have, I'll walk
you're gonna
out.
Have, then while you're having sex with her, you turn the lights out. I come and get the toupee, mm-hmm. and I go and do the audition for...
It's good to know that Feldman's ideas will die with him.
A lot of marketing possibilities with that show.
Sure.
Little kids running around with toupee, NBC logo toupees yeah. on.
Or is the logo like underneath the toupee, like on the inside?
You hang the tag like a...
Oh, like visor or something. Yeah.
Kristen Buckels, you're a producer now. Mm-hmm. Or you've been a producer.
I've been
with
a
Colin
producer.
Colin Quinn, mm-hmm. who's... Did you see Colin's special?
Yeah, wonderful.
Yeah, why even do stand-up after watching that?
That's how I feel.
That was Isn't a hostile gesture to me. That he did that...
The nerve of him
purely
to
make
excellent.
You feel less about make, yourself.
Yes. Kristen Buckels, you're a producer now over at Jax. Jax? Jack?
Jax.
Jack.
J-A-X.
And Andrew Goldstein, you're a producer now?
Yes.
So I'm the only creative one here.
Wow.
I'm the only gentle flower.
And we're out.
Kristen Buckels, what are you great at and why? In your deepest, most private moment, when you look at your career, what do you take pride in?
What do I take pride in?
What do you know that you do really well?
I'm very good at talking to people.
And why are you good at it?
I'm good at talking to people, and I'm good at convincing people to do insane shit they wouldn't normally do.
Why?
I don't know, because I make people feel comfortable. Except this situation right now.
Where did you learn that?
I would say dealing with rich people growing up.
People pleaser.
I'm a people pleaser.
You had to deal with rich people.
I grew up riding horses. I was not wealthy. I dealt with a lot of extremely wealthy people, and I learned how to manipulate them into doing what I wanted them to do as a kid.
For example?
I don't know, convincing them to give me horses and stuff to ride.
let the poor kid ride the horse.
Yeah, that's right.
How'd you do that? Did you play the sympathy card?
No. Look at me. I'm adorable.
Yes, you are.
Yeah. No, I'm joking.
Did you zero in? I was joking, too. Did you zero?
Also kidding.
Fake news.
Fake news. Alt fact.
Did you zero in on wealthy people? Do you have like, are you like the Terminator where you can, the wealth pops up on your eyelid?
No, I don't think I'm like a bullshit artist. I think I'm good at talking to people and actually finding out who they are and genuinely finding an interest and they therefore want to help me.
Will you waste time with somebody like me who has no money?
Well, I'm here, aren't I?
Andrew Goldstein, what are you most proud of that when you say, this is what I can do, this is a skill I have that can't be taken away from me, and why are you good at that?
Well, I've two separate questions. Most proud of, I always say that I survived, let's say, 16, 17 years in New York. No assistance, made it on my own.
That is impressive.
Always had an apartment in Manhattan, figured that out, roommates, whatever. So that would be prideful. That's probably my most prideful thing. And then what was the other question? The thing I'm really good at?
Well, that's what you're really good at. So you're a survivor.
Yeah. I work. I'm a worker. I work.
What's the longest period of time you've been out of work?
Well, after the NBC Page program, I was unemployed for a really long time until I figured it out. And then once that happened, it's never more than a few weeks unless I want it to be.
And how do you find work?
Being adorable. High five.
I'm very curious.
No, I just have, I'm very lucky. I've developed.
You're not lucky.
I've developed a network of people who that I have good standing with, and they are all super talented people who are doing really, really fun stuff. And I've been in really great situations where I've continually been hired by the same group of people.
And is there something nagging in the back of your head when you're working that you should be doing something else?
Yeah, there's a movie inside me, and there's scripted things inside me, and I have definitely fallen in this hole of alternative television and being really good at making that.
Mm-hmm. But
I see people that are writing sitcoms and writing movies and selling movies, and I'm like, man, if I could just have like 3 months off.
Right.
I'm
not really interested in what you're saying. I'm just trying to ignore Kristen Buckels.
Yeah. Oh my That's God. It. That's the thing. I feel like those are
his specialty.
I didn't even hear what he was saying.
It's not interesting.
You know what?
I'm
trying to keep him here as long as possible.
Sure.
Because he's got a dog.
I do have to leave.
Waiting for him in his apartment.
I do need to leave.
And I want to see how long I can keep him on the show.
I'm just waiting until you stop talking so I can get iced coffee.
So he can go home and the dog will have crapped in the apartment. That's my goal. I will have been successful if you come home.
Into a hot steaming duty. I'll say this. He has duties in the same spot all of the time if he goes in the apartment. And luckily it's not on the rug. It's always on the floor, which works out.
Oh, so, that's good.
I don't know how dogs do that, but they like the same spot.
Me too.
Sure.
Yeah. A prostitute's mouth.
Oh,
wow.
God.
I was going to say bed.
Chest.
I was going to say
bed. A prostitute's chest.
I was going to say bed.
Your colostomy bag.
I was going to say bed. I was going to be polite and say I always take a dump in the same spot, my bed. You went right for a prostitute's mouth. That's pretty amazing, Kristen.
I left.
Yes.
There you go.
So there's a little tension between us.
There is.
Yeah. I understand that I failed you.
Tremendously.
I was supposed to do something, and I let you down because I'm self-serving, and I don't care
sure.
about the community.
Sure. Yeah, that adds up. To be fair, I think that the joke is ultimately on you. Because I will say, I think I should probably preface by saying that I was applying. I'll tell you, Andrew. I was applying to do the late night writer's workshop.
Mm-hmm.
So Lacey and I pulled Lacey Jekka, who's been on the show before, we put a packet together and we're like, and Colin helps us with everything. So we're
Colin
like,
Quinn.
Colin Quinn, we love Colin so much. And so we're like, that'd be fun. We'll have Feldman write us a recommendation letter. So we texted Alex and he's like, yeah, absolutely. No problem. Got to go through Alex. So, I think it was like, I text on like, I want to say like a Thursday or something. And I was like, Alex, we need this recommendation letter by no later than midnight on Sunday. No problem. By like Saturday at 4 p.m., I'm like, you know what? I've got a really strong feeling that Feldman's going to flake on this. So I called Colin and I was like, Colin, can you write us? I love you so much, Colin. I know that we ask you for so much. Can you? And he was like, of course. I love you, girls. I would do anything. Of course, I'll write this for you. Colin writes this glowing recommendation letter. And then I get a text from Feldman at like like the next day that it was past due, being like, so sorry, I ran out of time. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to make him write this. I'm going to drag this
he
out.
He still has to write it.
Absolutely. And I was like, yeah, no worries. No problem.
Wait, you already had Colin?
I already had
and
it.
And how many recommendations did you need?
One. So I led you on to make you feel guilty for weeks. I knew you were going to flake.
Had I written the letter, would it have been included?
No, I had to turn it in on Saturday. I would have kept it in my pile of things I made Feldman.
But she only she only turned to Colin because it got to the 0 hour and she needed. So you would have been
all
included.
Right. So
and to say, ultimately, Colin is much more familiar with my writing than Feldman is, to be fair.
True.
Okay. Before I get to the meat of it, let me first say I feel immensely guilty.
That, no, you
I do. I felt really bad. I would have given anything to write a letter of recommendation.
Right.
Had I felt you were worthy. No, I felt really bad. And I know there's an excuse. I can't remember which lie to tell you, but there's some. There was something.
Well, her rate she was offering you wasn't high enough.
This is for the late night. What is this?
Oh, it was the late night writers. They do late night writers workshops.
What is that?
It's like they NBC does it. It's in March. They do it every year. You like they have a bunch of these. You're supposed to be like diverse. So you have to be like, you know, the LGBTQ community or you have to be a woman or.
Oh, that's why I didn't write it.
Yeah, there you go. That adds up. So they give these opportunities. Actually, I think you can just submit if you're a white male as well. But I don't think you have a shot in hell. No, but and then they select like a couple of people and you do the workshop and you kind of get in front of these like NBC people and get your writing seen and stuff like that.
Well, you know, Andrew would qualify. He comes from a very, you know, that he grew up with a single mom, as did I. I grew up with a single mom. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we only had one mom.
Wow, that's crazy.
Our parents weren't lesbians.
Yeah.
And I think that should qualify me for something.
Sure.
We're oppressed.
That's our new joke for today. I think we have a good new joke. We came up with that.
You did?
Before you were here.
Okay.
Pre-Buckels.
Pre-Buckels.
You two are oppressed.
Well, I have a single... I'm from a single...
Anybody with a single mother.
How do you guys feel? Just like the end of an era. Like the white man is on its way out.
Oh, no. I don't know if you saw the election returns, baby.
Yeah, we're back.
We're back.
In a big way.
I have to admit...
Well, bigly. We're back bigly.
I have to admit, on a raw level...
Mm-hmm.
There is, well, I'm not going to say it.
Say it.
No. So, and how long would the program have lasted?
I think it's just a week or 2 weeks or something. I honestly don't know.
And what do you learn?
I don't know. That's why I would love to find
how
out.
How to take your job.
Yeah.
So it's how to write late night.
Yeah. I mean, like I do a lot of like my own, just like working on monologue and desk jokes and bits and all that stuff. But. I mean, yeah, but I, you know, when it's obviously
so
ultimately
would
to get hired.
Out, you would hang out at the Tonight Show?
I guess. I mean, I think it's ultimately, like, I just would like to, you know, I mean, like, getting into that, like, you know, whatever writing for, like, Jimmy Fallon or Seth Meyers or SNL or any of those, like, late night shows.
Mm-hmm.
It's, like, the ultimate goal for a lot of people. But I don't know.
And did you get in?
I don't know. I haven't found out yet.
I feel really bad. I feel bad.
No, you don't.
I do. I really do. I feel horrible.
You should.
I don't know if my writing a letter means anything.
Yeah, that's fair.
That's probably why I didn't write it.
No. Oh, my God. I don't know that they – I mean, I don't know. Like, they – I don't even – the recommendation letter is, like, optional. I honestly don't – I mean, I don't know how that stuff works because I feel like it takes – I feel – you know, like, I feel like Lacey and I put a really solid packet together, but – who knows?
Hmm.
You never know.
All right, here's the truth.
What?
This is why I didn't write the letter.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
And Goldstein, I want you to back me up on this.
Please don't.
I was kind enough to put you on this show. Hang on. Come back. Hang on. It is so typical of the people in my life and the people in this business. I give you the greatest gift possible.
Sure.
An appearance on the David Feldman
program.
Is that what it's called?
That's what I call it.
Where you can reach tens of people.
Tens of people. I will say when the first time I got offered to come on the show, I was worried. I was like, is this a joke? Am I being brought on as a joke?
I gave you an opportunity to spread your wings and fly, and it wasn't good enough. Then I get, can you recommend me for later?
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, it's never enough for your generation.
You're just like Sean Spicer. It's never enough.
It's
with
never
you people.
Enough.
It's never enough.
It's never enough.
That was
for
my
you
immediate.
People.
That was my immediate.
That was your immediate thought.
My immediate thought is, what are you going to do for me?
You know what my immediate thought was?
Yeah.
How that you can be a prestigious writer of some shows and your shirt is literally falling apart on your body. I find that puzzling.
Yeah. This is a nice shirt.
That is not a nice shirt.
It's not?
Look at the top.
There's a thread situation.
It's threadbare.
Look.
Jesus.
Alex hasn't ironed his shirt yet today, and so...
Alex has bigger fish to fry. I've had... I think I had one of the most infuriating phone calls of my life with Alex.
What?
Before.
What?
So obnoxious. So
why?
I feel like, you know, just like coming up in this industry, you do, you know, you're... Which this is just kind of like a strange industry to be in the first place.
Excuse me for one second. Sorry. What is the name of your dog?
Dusty.
Dusty. I want to keep him here.
He is squatting right now.
Go ahead.
Poor Dusty.
On my hardwood floors.
Dusty.
I hope he has the runs. Go ahead.
That's the meanest thing in the world. Save your piece.
Okay, so you had an infuriating...
Yes.
Okay.
So, I mean, so basically, I think that anybody you sort of like get advice from in this industry, no one really, just we've had this conversation before, no one really knows what's going on.
Right.
There are no rules.
Right.
No one understands.
It's Thunderdome.
It's Thunderdome.
We're all faking
it. It's chaos. We're all faking
it. It's Thunderdome as opposed to the Thunder dump that Dusty's taking
right now.
My little boy.
Poor Dusty. No one gives a flying rat's fuck where you went to college. They just want to know that you're going to show up and that you're going
like
to keep your mouth shut.
And you're going to be all right in the writer's room.
Yes, you're going to keep your mouth shut in the writer's room and you're going to do your job and just shut up. Mm-hmm. And how you get that job is because Bob in line producing knows Jim over in finance, who knows some dude's cousin, and he's going to bring him in, who used to work at the Y, but now they're going to bring him in over this other kid who worked their ass off because they just need somebody right now. And that's the cold, hard, honest truth of this industry. And so I'm talking to Alex on the phone, and he goes, you know what? It's just about people. It's just about working hard and getting your work out there. And I wanted to say, fuck you, because it's not the truth. I know plenty of people out there who work their asses off, who do shows every single week, who write more than anybody I've ever met in my entire life, and they're not recognized for it. So I do not believe that the harder you work, the more you get. I think being in the right place at the right time and being prepared for that opportunity and really committing to what you do is. But I don't believe that the harder you work, the more you get.
Well, I think in order to be prepared, you have to work very hard at being a white male.
Yeah. Work on that.
Becoming white. Okay.
Yeah. Try that.
So I kind of disagree with you.
Go ahead.
I think working very hard...
I think it's necessary. I don't think it's why you get a job.
I do.
I don't. Because I don't think that there's... Because I've seen too many scenarios where I've had the same people in a group and they all got hired. All of them work equally as hard, but they got selected because they were in that opportunity, in that position at that point in
time. But that just gets them in the door.
Sure. That's it.
I just want to use the term confirmation bias.
Okay, go ahead.
I don't know what it means.
Well used.
Thank you. I think you're looking at one situation and coming up with an explanation that confirms what you think.
Okay.
But.
I don't have many samples,
All that matters, in work, is a work ethic. I think in the end, all that anybody truly respects is how hard you work. I've even noticed it with this podcast. Alex and I have been crunching numbers. He hates me. What? I can't. We see.
Did you say coaching numbers one more time today?
Did I say really?
Oh my God.
Okay. All right.
It's the Jewish accountant in you.
All right. Alex and I have been cooking the books.
Cooking the books.
We've been going over and the harder we work on the show, the more popular
work
it
begets work.
Work begets work, and people respect a work ethic, especially in comedy. Especially in stand-up?
Sure.
I mean, you watch Colin's special?
No one works harder than Colin.
So you're wrong.
But I'm saying, but then you're using your same thing against me. That's a confirmation bias. I'm just saying that you're saying, what you're saying is that what people say to like people like me, millennials or whatever, is that
you're not a millennial.
I am a millennial.
You're not. You're different.
She's a millennial.
Thank you.
But that he's saying with the context that they're lazy and stupid.
Yeah.
I know, but I'm saying, so then why does the same, I think there's nothing more frustrating when I'm trying to get advice from somebody when they're like, you just have to work harder.
Yeah, that's shit advice.
It's shit advice.
It is shit advice to a woman. I'm serious.
What are you talking about?
I do think, from what I've been reading, I wasn't aware of this, but apparently in corporate America, women traditionally have not been given a fair shake.
I've never heard this.
This is what I've read.
Is this news?
This is news to me. And
the headlines at Feldos.
And that they're paid 70 cents on the dollar, which I think is wrong. They should be paid 72 cents on the dollar.
If that were true, it'd be really big news.
Yeah.
But so clearly.
No, in all seriousness.
Yeah.
I do know that women are told when they lean in and speak up, be patient. You'll get there. Just keep working hard. And that is that is oppression. That for women, that's a form of oppression. I agree with you.
It's frustrating.
It's more than frustrating. It's oppression. It's illegal. And Michelle Obama's speech when she went after Donald Trump, rewatch it, because that's exactly what she was saying, that women in their professional careers are constantly told, work harder, hang in there, your turn will come, and it doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
So as a white male, who gives a shit? No.
When's lunch? Am I right?
No, I mean, I agree with you.
Yeah.
I agree. And I apologize because at the beginning of this conversation, I really wasn't listening to you.
Sure. Yeah. No, that makes sense.
When you said that, because, yeah. But the answer, I guess, because I do like to tell women how to think.
Mm-hmm.
Mansplain.
Some mansplain.
I don't know what I think the answer is one of my daughters is.
Alex just sighed so loudly.
He just sighed.
Well, he was the victim.
Verbally.
He saw.
I got to go.
No. That shit has sailed. You're going home.
You'll be all right, Buckles.
No.
No, I'm doing great. You're not trying to bitch here.
Well,
I'm just saying, like,
if you really love me, Andrew Goldstein,
I do.
You'll stay here and go home to a stinky house. If you respect me as
Poor
a comedy
Dusty.
Writer,
but you, Dusty's sitting by the door right now. He's got the shit sweats. All he's thinking is, "Daddy'll be home soon, and I'm not going to disappoint him."
Shit
so
sweats.
This is more about.
Now
this is about mental warfare.
All over my apartment.
Did we come up with a great joke today?
We did. Single mothers.
Right. Can Dusty come up with a joke like that?
I'm sure he could.
No, but he's ridiculously adorable.
Has anything ever come out of me that you had to pick up with a tissue paper? No.
Give it 5 to 6 more years.
So you're going to go home. This is what's going to happen.
I'm going to literally go home and expect a duty.
You've evacuated for an evacuation is what you're doing. You're
it's
leaving.
Not that bad.
You're going home to shit, literally.
Well,
and when you're stooped over picking up that dog shit.
I will think of David Feldman.
You're going to say, you know, I could have stayed here.
No, when I am eye to eye with that steaming pile of horseshit, I will thank David Feldman.
How old is Dusty?
2 years old.
Aw.
So, on behalf of him and I say, I bid you adieu.
Good
thank
night,
you for
night.
Having
me. You bid us adieu.
I bid you adieu.
Bid you adieu.
Thank you for having me, Buckles. You'll be fine.
Thank you so much.
You'll be fine.
I'm going to take his seat.
Okay.
Oh, we have a guest?
Yeah.
Oh, somebody else is coming in.
Oh, are we pausing and waiting until 3:45?
No, we're going to keep going. Oh. I'm so glad he's gone.
Christ.
I'm so glad he's gone.
I really need iced coffee, Alex.
You need iced coffee?
I want iced coffee.
Do we have iced coffee for our guest?
Yes, Your Majesty.
Yes.
He hates me.
He hates me.
I plugged his podcast.
Whose podcast?
Andrew has a podcast here. Sorry, I've been so busy. It's part of the Showbiz family. It's with Matthew Golditch, and he's a great comedy writer.
Oh, really?
Who you should have gotten to recommend you for the late night program because he writes.
But why?
For
but
Seth
Colin
Myers.
Colin Quinn is the best.
When do you find out?
I think I find out pretty soon. I think it's they said in late February, and it is currently late February.
All right, so we're going to go over a couple of things I want to ask you.
Sure.
You are a successful millennial. You have a work ethic.
Yes.
You're out there. You're starting a brand new job. You keep relationships going.
Yes.
You put up with
insurmountable amount of minutiae and bullshit.
Why doesn't it get under your skin?
What?
Just the garbage. Why don't you take your ball and go home?
I think stuff does get to me, but I also feel like I'm getting to a place where I'm realizing that me getting frustrated about other people's bullshit is just poisoning me. It's not help. It's not. No one feels bad about giving me bullshit. So
you don't take it personally.
No, you can't. You just can't.
I need advice from you.
Yes.
Because I tend to take things.
Do you have any milk?
Yeah, I'll give milk.
God, sugar?
He gave you ice.
And coffee.
Ice. Speaking of ice, if you work for ice, shame on you.
Right.
You know that they're like checking for ID on the 6 train?
No, they're not.
Yeah, they are.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's terrifying.
It's pretty bad.
Yeah.
So I try not to take things personally.
Pardon
but sometimes
to?
I do.
Sure.
Especially when very successful people.
Uh-huh. You're the best.
You're the best.
Thank you so much.
Ah, there you go. Is that good?
It's great.
Who taught you not to take it personally?
I don't know. I had a career slash coach when I first moved to New York named Dallas Travers. I'm going to plug her because she's the best. And she helped me with a lot of that stuff. And then there's a book out right now. Wait, can I look at the title? Because I don't want to mess it up.
Well, sure. We're talking with Kristen Buckels.
Sorry.
And this is the self-help part
of
the show.
This is self-help that I will definitely plug.
I find it interesting, while you're looking, I find it interesting that Goldstein is always working. And you're always working.
I'm not always working. I will be. But let's see. The book is called You're a Badass, How to Stop Doubting Your Greatness and Start Living an Awesome Life by Jen Sincero. It's a number one New York Times bestseller. Go out and get it today.
And you know where you should buy it?
Where?
Go to the David Feldman Show website.
Do you have it?
Hang on.
Oh, through Amazon. I know what you're doing.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I get a little piece. Yeah. I can dip my beak.
You know, Amazon's a Trump supporter.
Bezos, first of all, owns the Washington Post.
He does?
Yes.
Okay.
He bought the Washington Post for $250 million, and he's reinventing newspapers. The Washington Post is a great newspaper.
Washington Post and New York Times are the only two papers I have on my phone.
Well, he saved the Washington Post, and he's creating a business model for future journalists.
You still haven't taught me how to read the New York Times, which I'm frustrated about.
Well, I will in a second.
Mm-hmm.
So, but Jeff Bezos did destroy Main Street.
Yes.
And he met with Trump. But is he on the Council of Economic Advisors? I don't think so.
No.
So how did he support Trump?
I thought that I was just on the list of things we're supposed to hate.
Well, I happen to have, I was going to have her on the show. There's a good Coulter. There's a bad Coulter and a good Coulter. Ann Coulter is the bad Coulter, but there's a Coulter out of San Francisco, and they profiled her in the New York Times.
Mm-hmm.
She runs Grab Your Wallet, and she...
Oh, yeah.
What is Grab Your Wallet? I'm looking for the list here.
I mean, I'm going to get this wrong, so I don't want to mess this up, but I will say that Grab Your Wallet, if I'm remembering correctly, is a blog or article or something that I've definitely seen on Facebook of things of that outlines different companies that support different things and which companies you can go to instead that support the correct things.
Right. And it's grabyourwallet.com.
Yeah. Sorry.
As opposed to Steve Bannon's website, grabyourwallet.org. Which is what Steve Bannon does.
That's Steve Bannon's website?
Yeah, he grabs his wallet whenever he sees a black man enter a room.
Is that good, Alex? Did I make it funny? That was good, right?
That was great. You're doing great, Feldman.
I'm doing good.
You're doing great.
Mommy, I made a duty. Mommy, I made that's when I drive Alex crazy.
Yeah.
When I have
when you just drive him nuts.
When I do something well, I'll go, Mommy, I made a duty.
Jesus Christ.
Mommy. It's all about toilet training.
Yeah. It really
is.
Yeah.
It's how you're toilet trained.
Is it?
Yes.
That's interesting.
If you are, according to Freud.
Uh-huh. What is it?
If you're shamed by your duty.
Oh, my God. You should never be shamed by your duty.
Then you're greedy.
Really?
Yeah. And you have, because your duty is the first thing you've offered to the world. So when it's you're making an offering to the world. And if your parents go, ew, that's disgusting. Then you're not going to be creative and you're going to be tight with money, according to Freud.
The fact that my stepson pooped and I cheered for him is a good thing.
Do you know why I never have writer's block?
Why?
Because every time I pooped, my parents would eat it.
Oh, Jesus, he ruins everything.
That's how much they encourage
How much longer until someone else gets here?
You want me to write that letter for you?
Yeah. When do I get to go?
I did that with all my kids.
What? You ate their feces?
I would eat their poop because I wanted, it was their offering to the universe, and I felt
that. Kind of backfired for you, didn't it?
And I said, you're so creative, and I would eat their poop because I'm a strict Freudian.
Okay. Let's get back to
Back to saving the country. These
about.
Are some companies that you should boycott.
Let's hear it.
Well, here, we'll go back and forth.
Okay.
This is from Grab Your Wallets. You should boycott World Wrestling Entertainment. Linda McMahon is now the head of Small Business Administration under Trump. She donated, is this $6 million? She donated $6 million to Donald Trump and his allies.
Wow.
So you should stop watching World Wrestling Entertainment, according to Grab Your Wallet. Your turn.
Fascinating that people watch it anyways. Am I just going off of right here?
Yeah.
How do you say this last name? Steve?
Oh, Mnuchin.
Mnuchin. Okay. Steve Mnuchin of Goldman Sachs. Looks like he donated $5,400 to Trump and allies, and now the Department of Treasury Secretary. Goldman Sachs. Okay.
So I'm boycotting Goldman Sachs.
Okay.
We were going to do, Alex, when is our IPO? This podcast was going to go public, right?
Yeah.
And they were going to underwrite the public offering. Well, this was going to be a stock that was going to be traded.
Okay.
But because of Steve Mnuchin, we're not going to do business with Goldman Sachs. And
okay.
He's what's his new title? He's a cabinet secretary, head of treasury?
Department of Treasury Secretary.
I am boycotting money.
Me too.
Because this pig is in the Trump administration.
Also because it sucks.
I'm going to use my credit card. I'm not going to use cash.
Okay.
From now on, I use only my credit card.
Okay.
David Friedman. I don't know who he is or what he's done, but I'm boycotting Judaism.
Oh, I like that. Okay.
Your turn.
Wilbur Ross, W.L. Ross & Co. donated $5,400 to Trump and allies, plus $956,000 to conservatives from 1990 to 2016. And he's now the Department of Commerce Secretary.
He's the Secretary of Commerce.
I don't even know what W.L. and Ross or W.L. Ross & Co. is.
So boycott commerce.
Boycotting commerce.
Peter Thiel, head of Planeteer Technologies.
Uh-huh.
He spoke at the Republican convention.
Okay.
He put Gawker out of business. He sued Denton,
wow,
the publisher of Gawker, because he bankrolled. He had all this money that he made from PayPal. So he bankrolled the lawsuit. What's his name? The wrestler. What's his name? It's hot in here.
It is hot in here.
Huh? Hulk Hogan's lawsuit.
Oh, he did?
Against Gawker was bankrolled by Peter Thiel because Peter Thiel wanted to put Gawker out of business. And he was mad at Gawker for outing him. Peter Thiel is gay.
Okay.
So he wanted to get even with Denton for outing him. So he bankrolled the lawsuit that put
Mr. Denton out of business. So I am boycotting gay sex. I am no longer having gay sex because of Peter Thiel. Your turn.
Rex Spillerson. You know where I got that joke?
No, it's horrible.
You did it.
What? I don't get it.
You get it.
Rex Spill. His name is Rex Tillerson.
Spillerson. Because of ExxonMobil.
Do you know that he is a closeted Muslim?
He's a closeted Muslim?
There's one human being listening who's going to get this joke. I just made it up.
Go ahead.
His real name is Rex T for the Tillerson.
Okay.
You don't get that, do you?
I don't get it.
Cat Stevens? Who converted to Islam?
Oh, really?
And he had an album called T for the Tiller.
I didn't know that.
So the joke is Rex T for the Tillerson.
Okay.
I hate myself.
Anyways.
I'm going to self-harm today.
Yes. Rex Tillerson, ExxonMobil, donated too much money and is a large piece of poop, and he is a department state secretary now.
Cherna Moskowitz. I'm boycotting Jewish women.
You're boycotting.
I don't know who Cherna Moskowitz is. Let me just say something. This is David Feldman speaking. If your name is Cherna Moskowitz, you have to be on your best behavior.
Yes.
Otherwise, change your name to Cherna Mosque.
Yes.
And let the Muslims get the blame.
Yeah. There you go.
But if your last name is Moskowitz, you have to be on your best behavior.
Sure.
All right. I think we've done enough damage, right?
Yeah, I feel good.
Oh, Linda Bean.
And also Betsy DeVos, because she's terrifying.
Although she was trying to keep the transgender bathroom.
Oh, she was?
She got overruled by Jeff Sessions. So in her defense, stood up for transgender people.
Okay.
L.L. Bean. This is interesting. Linda Bean. By the way, do you know who Orson Bean is?
No.
He is Andrew Breitbart's father-in-law.
Really?
Yeah. Andrew Breitbart died in 2012, but Andrew Breitbart married Orson Bean's daughter.
I didn't know that.
And you don't know who Orson Bean is?
No.
Unfortunately, most of my listeners do.
So sorry, you guys. I let you down.
As I mentioned earlier, we're heard in every nursing home.
Every nursing home in the tri-state area.
The way this podcast works is most sons don't want to visit their aging parents. So they just play the podcast in nursing homes.
Yeah.
And most old Jews think
it's their son.
Their son is visiting them.
That's good.
Yeah.
Doing something right.
Mm-hmm. So Linda Bean, one of the owners of L.L. Bean, gave $60,000 to Donald Trump, and she also gave an illegal donation to Making America Great Again, which violated laws given to us by the Federal Elections Commission. So do you shop at L.L. Bean?
No.
As I said earlier in the show, that it's not good enough to boycott a company.
Yeah.
You have to let them know you're boycotting it.
You have to voice it.
Yeah.
Tweet, Facebook, Snapchat. Right.
Like I've called Bloomingdale's and said I'm not going to wear Ivanka's shoes.
Right. And they're like, should we stop all those orders for your heels, Feldman?
This is David Feldman. At 9 o'clock every evening, I become Star.
Mm-hmm.
And Star, S-T-A-R-R, Star.
Sure.
I go to Saks, and I get a makeover.
Mm-hmm. Then every day.
Every day. I change into a gown.
Uh-huh.
And I get on the A train.
Sure.
And I ride the A train all night as Star.
All night?
With a wig. I wear it.
When that train's not going express, that's a long ride.
And I have a Chanel No. 5 knockoff that I reek of.
Uh-huh.
And I used to wear Ivanka's red shoes.
Sure.
But not anymore.
Because?
Well, actually, I never did. Star did.
Star did. Okay.
Star.
I feel this is going to
Have you ever met Star?
No, I've never met Star.
She's actually very kind.
Yeah.
Unless you say something hurtful.
Yeah.
Then Star can lash out.
Sure.
especially on the A train.
This bit is really old.
When she's ignored.
Okay.
Star does not like to be ignored on the A train.
All right.
That's why she
When's Giulia getting here?
That's why Star wears so much of the Chanel No. 5 uh-huh. knockoff. What is your discipline? Are you a morning person?
I wish I was. I'm kind of not.
What time do you normally get up, and do you stick to a schedule? Do you have that kind of discipline?
When I'm working like consistently at a job where I have to be there at a certain time, yes. But if I'm left to my own devices, I get up around 9.
You get up at 9. Suppose you've had a late night.
I would say late night, or like I'm letting myself sleep in. I can sleep until like 11:30.
What's the latest you go to bed?
The latest?
Yeah.
Probably 2 or 3.
Do you ever find it 6 in the morning?
No.
And the A train is stuck and...
I think I would be just in tears in a puddle at that point.
That's how Star usually ends her evening.
on the A train in tears in a puddle.
Are there ever days where you can't sleep?
Yes.
And what do you do?
Usually I get up and I read. Or I meditate.
Meditation
yeah.
is very important.
Yes. I'm trying to be much better about it.
I've been told that's the secret to survival in the age of Trump.
Yes, I think it is.
To meditate. To tap into something bigger than all of us.
Yes. I think so. I've been doing...
I think of Chris Christie.
Chris Christie?
Instead of meditating.
That's what you do? That's your mantra?
Well, he's bigger than all of us.
He is bigger than all of us.
God, Alex, I'm trying to be funny here. If you keep... Hang on. Put the noose down. There's no need to kill yourself.
Alex is going crazy.
How long do you meditate for?
My goal is to meditate twice a day for 20 minutes.
And do you have a mantra?
Yes.
What is it?
I can't tell you.
Why?
It's Vedic meditation. I was given my mantra through a 7-week course that I took 5 years ago, and I was told that I could not tell anybody my mantra, so I'm not. Jaya. Nope.
You know what my mantra is?
What?
It's very spiritual.
What is it?
I never should have let my ex-wife keep the car.
I feel like that might not be serving you.
That's spiritual, right?
Sure.
I repeat it over and over
again.
And I just focus on her driving my car.
Yeah.
And having fun.
That makes more sense for where you are personally in life. That's your mantra.
Is that spiritual?
Yeah, absolutely.
And 20 minutes, does your mind go blank?
No, I think it's I just spend the entire time trying to doing my mantra and just, it's very, I think that the reason meditate, and I really don't know, I'm not like a professional or anything, but I think the interesting thing about meditating is just you become aware of like sort of the chatter in your brain mm-hmm. and like what's the thing you're focusing on and then actively letting it go and letting your mind go blank.
And you can
again.
Meditate professionally. You said you're not a professional meditator.
No, I don't think anybody's a professional.
You just said you're not a professional.
No, I think some people are.
Can I hire you to meditate for me?
No. You do it yourself.
Wouldn't that be great? Why don't you do a service where people like me are way too busy.
Uh-huh.
Can't we hire somebody to meditate for us?
Something tells me you don't understand meditation.
I do.
Yes. You have to do it yourself.
Well, I don't have time. I'm a power broker.
That's such a bad excuse. I don't have time.
Well, maybe if you had meditated for me, I could have written the letter to the late night program.
Another excuse.
I had to meditate.
Your excuses are exhausting.
You don't think there's a way to start a business?
I would imagine that you were just in some sort of like YouTube hole, and that's why you don't have time.
I'm pretty good with my time.
Okay.
What's your
discipline?
My discipline, in all honesty?
Yeah, no, I'm serious. What's your routine? Walk me through your morning routine.
Well, Star comes home at 6. Then she showers.
Sure.
She dips her hair uh-huh. into the sink.
When's Giulia getting here?
Do you have a to-do list? My secret is a not to-do list.
Is it not
I just learned
list?
That from Tim Ferriss. A
Wait,
not
really?
To-do list.
Oh, no, I have a to-do list. I have an urgent list and a not-so-urgent list.
What is the not so urgent list?
Like stuff that I would like to do, but it's not urgent. And then another stuff that just like needs to be done.
And do you make it every day?
Yes.
What time?
I would say wake up. I do coffee, social media, a little bit of emails. And then I round like, I would say 10:30, I go through and I make my lists.
And how long does it take you to make a list?
I don't know, 15 minutes.
See, I think the secret to life is lists.
Lists. I feel like people are very disorganized in general. Lists mm-hmm. help.
And you want to get it off your brain and onto a piece of paper so you
yeah.
can see your turmoil. You got to be able to look at your turmoil.
Physically look at it.
Because our brains are not designed to hold nuisance tasks inside.
No.
We're designed to stave off the attack of a gazelle.
Yes.
Not to pick up our dry cleaning.
No.
So when that's swimming in our head, dry cleaning, coffee filters, make sure
yeah.
you fed the child tied to the,
yes.
the radiator in the
outside.
Basement.
Jesus Christ.
All those little, that's just nuisance.
Yeah.
Do you find that you can be busy but not productive?
Yes, absolutely.
Isn't that the secret to a not to-do list?
I think so.
Where you say, I could answer all these emails,
uh-huh.
that'll keep me busy, but I'll have nothing to really show for my day.
Right. Yeah, I feel like when I'm feeling like desperate or just not great about myself, I do lots of emails.
When you're in love.
Yep.
Have you ever been in love?
I am in love.
Well, I'm sorry, but you're my daughter's age, and this has to be. Are you in love?
Mm-hmm.
Good for you.
Thank you.
And when you're in love,
uh-huh.
everything feels good.
Yeah.
You're where you need to be.
Mm-hmm.
The universe makes sense.
In love, maybe not in everything else.
When you have a to-do list.
Yeah.
There's really one thing you need to do.
What?
Well, everybody has a different thing that they need to do. But in the don't clear your throat on my show.
I'll do whatever I want, Feldman.
When you filter your life through being in love.
Uh-huh.
Everything's great. Right?
Yeah.
When you're in love, anything that happens, good or bad, you can't wait to tell the priest that you're in love with or the...
Sure.
I had to go there.
Yeah,
panicked.
You did.
I panicked.
You bailed.
I panicked.
That's why you'll never be Colin Quinn.
No, I never will be.
You bailed.
And I know that that
Colin
special...
Colin commits.
That was an affront to me. He did that special, mm-hmm. the most recent special, just to show me... What a bad comic I am.
Yeah.
But when you're in love, everything is about, oh, I can't wait, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
When you have tasks, it's the same thing as being in love. There's one person you love, and there's one task that you know you need to be doing.
What's the task?
Well, it's up to you to decide.
Where are you going with this?
What I'm saying is that my troubles start when I start the day and finish the day doing everything but the one thing I'm supposed to be doing. And I think most of us
uh-huh.
fail because we have a to-do list of 200 things.
Yeah.
And there's really one important thing.
That we should be doing.
And that is the thing we're not doing.
Yeah, that's fair.
And then all of a sudden, those 199 things that you're supposed to do
become urgent.
Take care of themselves. If you do the one thing you're supposed to do,
yeah,
then the 199 things that you're supposed to be doing.
That's actually fairly insightful.
Take care of themselves.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with love, because if you're in love and
yeah.
you're that every all the other nuisances in life tend to.
Isn't that just a lesson on perception? Because it's not the love, it's just how you feel.
It's how you feel.
Right. It's how you're viewing it.
Right.
And when you're in love, you generally feel pretty good. So everything else feels pretty good because it is pretty good. But when you're not feeling great and things aren't great, it's not that the things aren't great. It's that's how you feel about it.
So if, hypothetically speaking,
uh-huh.
if I were in love with somebody,
Uh-huh.
The
very hypothetically
the
speaking.
Sun rises and sets with this human being, and I filter all of life's experience through this love that I feel for this other person.
Yeah.
If in the morning I have forgotten to get coffee filters,
uh-huh,
and I am caught taking yesterday's coffee filter and rinsing it in the sink,
uh-huh,
and it's still perfectly good. I didn't turn the tap water on so powerfully that it blew a hole in the coffee filter.
Right.
And I'm able to
is
then...
Is this like a summer blockbuster, just like an enormous budget with a plot that goes nowhere?
I'm just saying that if I then take the coffee filter, uh-huh, and reuse it...
Yes.
Because I'm so in love that I forgot to get new coffee filters.
Right. So what's the problem here?
Exactly. What's the problem? Why should somebody criticize me for not getting coffee filters?
I feel like you're leaving out details here. Who criticized you for forgetting coffee filters?
It doesn't matter.
It does matter.
I'm just saying that if you're in love, it should solve all problems.
I don't think it
solves
all problems.
And remove all criticism.
No.
If you're, do you criticize somebody you're in love with?
I don't think you criticize them, but I think you naturally are just around that person so much that you start to try to help them and do being able to. I think when you're around somebody enough, you start to see where they are self-sabotaging themselves in certain right. ways. So you can sort of say, hey, I've noticed that, you know, that you do this
mm-hmm.
and you say this.
Mm-hmm.
I would just like to bring that to your attention.
Right. And do you think that might be a trait of a certain type of human being? And by certain type of human being, I mean who?
Type A personalities?
Mm-hmm.
Women?
Do you think women... I'm just asking for a friend.
Mm-hmm.
Does it really matter if a coffee filter is being reused the next day because you forgot to go get...
I don't know what type of person would be upset about that kind of thing, but personally, if for some reason my boyfriend said he was going to get coffee filters and then he didn't get coffee filters, I personally wouldn't care because I'll just go down the street and get coffee, and I like going out down the street and getting coffee, so it's not a big deal. But the problem for me in there would lie that somebody said they were going to do something and didn't do it.
Ah, yes.
It's the follow-through. Sure.
Somebody forgot to get coffee filters.
And what does the lack of the follow-through say for other things?
Right. But in the scheme of things, of all the horrible things I'm capable of doing as a human being.
Monstrous. Right.
You choose to fixate... on the fact that I forgot coffee filter.
But don't you understand it's not the coffee filter?
Yeah.
It's not the coffee filter.
What is it?
It's your lack of follow-through.
But you wouldn't know about the follow-through if you weren't coiled in the grass like a snake watching me, waiting for me to make a mistake. Why are you watching me make coffee? Why do you have to spy on me to see that, he didn't get coffee filters.
This sounds like the tip of the iceberg of something that was a long buildup to the snake coiling in the grass.
Well, do you think in certain relationships, there's usually one person who is waiting for the other person
to mess up? Yes. But I think that they're waiting for the other person to mess up because there's something bigger going on. There's something like they're not happy in a certain thing, so they want them to mess up in a way.
Do you believe in unconditional love?
Yes.
Do you believe that you can love something unconditionally, like Dusty the dog?
Like Dusty the dog.
Who will sometimes have an accident.
Uh-huh. But we love Dusty anyways.
But we love Dusty, and you clean up the poop.
Mm-hmm.
And do you say bad Dusty?
No, because that's for different reasons. You don't punish a dog later. If you want to punish somebody or something, you punish them while they're doing it. You can't punish them weeks or hours later, especially for dogs, because they don't understand.
Is it asking too much for me to be treated the same way you would treat a dog?
When is Giulia getting here?
Not you. No, hang on for 1 second. What's worse?
What?
Because I'm winning this discussion.
You're not winning this discussion.
Yes, I am.
No, you're
I'm
not.
Winning. Yes, I am.
Okay, what?
What's worse?
What?
My reusing a coffee filter.
Yeah.
And not telling you.
I just think that's the stupidest thing in the world.
Or taking a dump in the corner of the apartment.
Taking a dump in the corner of the apartment, but you're not a dog.
So I, but.
I win. You're not a dog.
So I'm.
Alan.
What? So do you think that is a, let me ask you a question.
What?
Do you think that's fair?
I.
Can you find justice in a relationship, Your Honor? Can there be justice in a relationship between two people?
Between the snake in the grass and the coffee filter man? Is that what you're asking?
Can you find justice? Can two people live together and find justice?
No. It's about compromise. And it's about being able, I feel like the snake should be able to let go of the stupid coffee filter things. Because there's just like so many battles you can, there's only so many battles you can pick. And the coffee filter feels like a very weird battle to pick.
Or do you think maybe the snake is just looking for a fight?
Yeah, that's what I said.
Do you think maybe the snake is feeling miserable?
The snake is unhappy and the snake wants to find a mistake so the snake can fight.
So that the snake can blame the unhappiness on something other than the snake.
Yes. Which is a very natural thing for a snake to do.
Okay.
What did I just solve?
I don't know. But this was good. You're going to stick around, right?
Yeah, I'm very confused.
Okay, we'll be right back. Welcome back. Giulia Rossi joins us. I pronounced Rossi, right?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. She's a writer, comedian, actress. Oh, my God. Look at these credits. Where do I begin? Oh, my God.
Please, Feldman, spare us.
I mean, it's amazing. You've seen her on Chelsea Lately, Comedy Central's This Is Not Happening, The Jim Gaffigan Show, VH1, True TV, Lifetime, Playboy TV. Her album True Love was released on Comedy Records last winter and was recently named one of SiriusXM Comedy's top albums of 2016 and one of the Comedy Bureau's 100 Best Things in Comedy in 2016. Please welcome Giulia Rossi. Wow.
Hi.
I saw you do stand-up, and I remember thinking, she's funny. But apparently you don't need me to tell you you're funny.
Oh, I need everybody to tell me I'm funny.
You were born in...
Most people don't need your affirmation, for the record, Feldman.
Oh, is that your dynamic?
Good night. Thank you.
Wow.
Is that what I'm here for?
That was great. That was perfect. You're a... you do solo shows, Stupid Foreigners and Bad Bride.
Yeah, I did. Wow. Well, I did. They're done.
God, this is really interesting. Well, I could just keep going on here.
God, Jesus. I didn't know this is this is a self-esteem workshop for
Absolutely.
Me.
You've performed at the Boston Comedy Festival, Bridgetown, Hell Yes Fest, Women in Comedy Festival. How long have you been doing comedy?
Say 12 years. That sounds about right.
And you've written for Esquire, Playgirl, Bust Magazine. Wow.
I mean, I've never had anyone be so kind.
It's not one of his strongest suits.
Really,
so
I feel really
good.
Uncomfortable. Well, this is the whole podcast. It's the whole podcast.
The whole podcast
me.
Is us reading your bio.
Yeah. Well.
Bust Magazine.
Yeah, that's a magazine.
He
has a few copies.
Cool. I write for Male Bust Magazine.
Oh, nice. It's for Moob. Is that what it's called? Man Boobs?
Gynecomastia is what it's called.
Is it really?
Gynecomastia. So is Bust Magazine, is that a gentleman's magazine?
Nope. It's a women's magazine. It's a great magazine. Do you read it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a great magazine.
Wow. Okay. I'm intimidated.
Feldman's officially out of his element.
Scared.
So you grew up in Boston. Your parents are Italian.
Yes.
Italian immigrants. I have a theory, and then I'll shut up.
Thank God.
Dennis Leary's parents were Irish. That he's the child of immigrants.
Okay.
Do you have an advantage to having immigrants for parents?
In what sense?
That you understand America better than a third generation American.
I don't know if I understand America better. I mean, I grew up not quite fitting. Like, I grew up in Belmont, Massachusetts. Mitt Romney is probably the the famous Belmontian. Also, there's a huge Mormon church there. So it's,
very cool.
It's, you know, it's like a white, upper white middle class town. So I grew up not feeling white totally, but also didn't fit in with like the English as a second language kids. So I don't know if I have a better perspective on America, but I definitely,
Work ethic.
I
opportunity.
Sure. Well, oh God, there's a lot of words being thrown at me. I think
I'm having a stroke. It has nothing.
Yeah.
To
oh
do.
God.
It's fairly normal.
I think that what I noticed growing up, perhaps maybe that some people didn't, was differences more, but not in like a negative way. In like a. Like, I've always been really interested in, like, sociology and culture. So I'd be like, oh, this kind of kids do this, and this kind of kids do this. And, I mean, you know, I sort of teeter-tottered between American culture and European culture. And then I also definitely noticed, like, European Italians versus, like, the third, fourth generation, like, Italian, American, you know, that kind of Italian. But, yeah, as work ethic.
Because obviously you really work at your stand-up, you work at your writing, and I think one of the advantages to having parents who are immigrants, what the advantage is that they came to America, I would suspect, for work.
And yeah, I mean, my dad, you know, he came here when he was 15. My mom came later when she was almost 30. They met here. But my dad...
Your mother married your father when he was 15?
Yes, exactly. No, no.
Mary-Kate Letourneau?
Okay, no. She came later. They met when they were in the same age. But he wanted to go to college, but, you know, he had to start school like 2 years. He was 2 years older than everyone because the schooling was different. And you know, his guidance counselor told him that he probably should learn a trade instead. So that has motivated him for his entire life. He still talks about this guidance counselor. And the guy, I mean, my dad is unbelievably self-made and works so hard. I almost feel like I had the opposite. So it's interesting to me that you think I work really hard, because I guess I do, but because there hasn't always been money attached to the work, it's sometimes hard for me to appreciate it.
Because my dad's
work ethic is all financially based.
I know.
You know,
I
so know. There's this weird thing where I'm sometimes like, man, I'm such a piece of shit. And then
I know.
My friends are like, you literally never stop. And I'm like, yeah, but.
I'm so glad you brought that up, because the thing that's been nagging at me is I love doing this podcast, but, you know, doesn't make any money. And it does make that's unfair to the people who donate. So I apologize. We're breaking even. But I was in America. If it doesn't make money, it has no value. If you're not getting rich off something, it has no value. The things that bring me the most joy, stand up, writing for myself, doing this podcast, six state killing spree. It just doesn't.
Sure.
It doesn't bring you the money. So you struggle with that.
Not really. In the past year or two, I feel like it's less, and maybe it's just getting older and having better mental health coping skills and all that stuff and boundaries. But I mean, it really, it was, my 20s. I mean, I didn't commit. Like, you asked how long I've been doing comedy. Like, I mean, I could say 10 years. I could say 18. Like, I really had one foot in, one foot out for a good portion of the beginning of it, because I was afraid to commit to it because there was no guarantee that any money would come. And when you're not making money, you're pretty much worthless. And how I grew up, you know, it's all about money. But now, you know, I guess I'm an adult. And I've gotten calmer about trusting, like, I do okay, you know, like, I get by. But I probably also have the advantage that, you know, I was raised privileged, even though I come from immigrant parents. You know, my dad paid for college. I didn't have student loan. Like, I was My parents aren't frivolous by any means. They only go out to eat if they have a coupon, which is probably why they have money. But, you know, it's a, probably a little... I'll explain this. So I feel the disappointment of not being rich, but I also have a little bit of a safety net of, like, especially I think in, like, Italian, at least all the Italians I know, like my cousins, like, you're never, I'm never going to be homeless. You know what I mean? Like, the whole family takes you in. They take care of you. I could have lived at home until I was 40 if I wanted to.
How many brothers and sisters?
I have one older sister.
So yeah. It's not a big
nope.
Italian family.
No, I mean, my mom has six brothers. So, like, the extended family is big, but the...
And are they all back in Italy?
Or? They all live within 5 miles of each other in Massachusetts. I'm the only one that lives out of state.
All her brothers?
Everybody. Cousins, brothers, paisan,
and what
friends,
about your dad? What about your dad's family?
Same thing. Oh, they all
Everybody left Italy.
Everybody left Italy. Yeah, they all left together.
What part of Italy?
My mom is from Sperlonga, which is a beach town near Rome. And my dad is Abruzzi region. So both from like the middle of Italy.
Hmm. Do you go back there?
I did a semester abroad in college, so I went to Italy for a little bit. My parents have never been back.
Really?
Never,
ever. Are they allowed back?
They're totally allowed back. It is. I've accepted so many things about them that I don't necessarily agree with. That is the one that like still, it kills me. Like I'm so sad.
They just
about
won't?
It.
Or they like?
They just, they're, you know, they're like stuck. Kind of, it's not, I feel like it's...
Are they afraid they're going to want to move back?
No, God, no. No, they just, they don't, you know, I don't know, they make a lot of excuses. They're like, oh, now's not the right time. Oh, we're getting, oh we can't because your sister, oh, we can't, like, there's, mm-hmm. they're those kinds of people. Their favorite day of the week is someday. Like, I always make that joke about them because they, yeah. It's always like, oh, someday. And, you know, I think maybe they don't really want to travel together for that many weeks. I mean, it's just, they just get very overwhelmed by big plans.
Are there relatives they want to see back then? Do they stay in touch?
My mom, we just got her an iPad last year, so she started to FaceTime with some old, you know, like cousins and old friends. But, I mean, the immediate family all came, so it's not really so much that. But, I mean, who doesn't want to go home? But they've never gone, and they can afford it. It's just, it's a weird... Thing. They're just kind of, my dad, I mean, I think the last time my dad left the state was probably to visit me at college in upstate New York. And that was like, you know, 10 years ago or whatever, wow. More than that.
I think it's built into the American DNA to cut yourself off from the past. You come to America to reinvent yourself. And if you're born in America, you move to another part. It's big enough that you can go someplace else. Reinvent yourself, and forget your past.
Hmm.
And I think we're a lonely people.
Americans?
I think Americans are lonely because we were built by people who left their families and their country. And there's something our grandparents or your parents were willing to cut themselves off. They said goodbye, and they made peace with the fact that they may not see their mother and father ever again.
Well, their parents came with them.
Okay.
A very touching story, Feldman. Yeah. It doesn't apply.
Yeah.
But they gave the middle finger to their past.
Yeah, I can see that. I mean...
And I think it's built into the country. I think your parents bake it into you, and then... You don't see your parents that often.
I see them pretty often. I see them like once a month.
Okay, my kids.
Thank you so much. Good night.
And I talk to my mom every day.
Okay.
It's weird because we actually have a
deeper dive into how Feldman doesn't understand
yeah.
women.
No. I hear what you're saying. I mean, you know, I can't speak for all Italian immigrant families, but we're a very, you know, codependent. Everyone's in each other's business. There's no way that I couldn't go home. If I go more than 6 weeks without seeing my family, I get a little anxious. Like, we're very...
Well, Kristen Buckels, would you say in America, mm-hmm. when somebody says you're dead to me, they mean it?
This feels like a personal experience. You're asking for a friend?
I think in America...
Thank you, Alex.
People say you're dead to me, and you remain dead to them.
I'm going to need some context on this.
I mean, I don't think you can be dead to anyone with social media.
Yeah, that's true.
That's the thing.
I think you can ghost. I think in this country.
You can ghost people.
I think in this country, it's very easy to sever a relationship.
I have a hard time making such a firm statement about everyone because I think everyone's a little different.
I have no show if I follow that rule.
I know. It's like the opposite of what a comedian is supposed to do. You just have to
Sweeping generalizations that aren't true.
I don't know because I don't feel that way. I have a hard time having people be dead to me. I sort of always leave a tiny window for people to be different and prove that they're better.
I've definitely cut people out of my life, but that's not to say that, like, you know, I check their Facebook like once every 3 months. Or like if I saw them again in the future, I wouldn't speak to them or something. But I think I get a sense of, or especially like when I like left New Mexico, like I have a few friends that like actually flew out here to like visit me afterwards. And I remember them like leaving and like giving them a hug and thinking like, oh, wow, I'm never going to see you again. Not because I don't like them or like anything, but it's just there's just the likelihood of us ever like getting together ever again is just so slim. That it's like this sort of, I get this like weird like gut feeling of like, oh man, this is it. You're going to go lead a whole big life without me. And that's crazy. Like, best of luck.
And yet technology is bringing us back together in limited ways.
Yeah.
There are now friendships I have on Facebook. And it's just implicit that this is as far as it's going to go.
I left Facebook a month ago.
You did. That was a big move.
Yeah.
That was a big move.
I just have.
You know about that?
Did I know about it? I had to go and like her page and I had to like make sure to follow her on Twitter. But yeah, no.
Yeah, I just have a page.
Yeah.
Why did you leave?
Because I didn't like those friendships. I didn't like that there was people that liked everything that I posted.
This is really interesting.
But I've never met them. I didn't like running into people that I actually care about. To a certain degree, you know, acquaintance-wise, and then being like, hey, you know, you heard about my son, right? And I'm like, no. And they're like, oh, but I posted about it. It's like, but I didn't.
Just assuming you're following every detail of their life.
I just didn't.
Wow.
I try is the key word. I'm not saying I've mastered social media. Social media is a new drug. We're all trying to figure out the right dose. Like, I get it. But for me, I just felt like, I was seeing sides of people I didn't like. I was seeing.
Like what?
Like, you know, family members that had very different political views than me. And I was bummed because I had just maybe reconnected with them. And I also don't want to get into debates in the comment section.
Right.
I try to only use social media to promote myself or promote positive things or like action things. If I'm going to get political, I want it to be like, here's a link to, you know, like not always. And I just didn't want to see the rants. And I feel like a huge problem with the country right now, or whenever this comes out is because this could be evergreen is that I think social media, for as much as it's brought people together to mobilize and it's made us aware and all the wonderful stuff that it does, I also think it's created a false sense of accomplishment or in general, activism, if we're going to talk about that. But like, you know, people will post a rant, but then now they're learning they actually have to go out and volunteer. Like for comedy, for example, there were days where I would like get 250 likes on a joke and then I'd be like, huh, I guess I did something today. And then I'm like, wait, I haven't done any actual. For me personally, it was a false sense of action. And Facebook was sort of the first one that I felt like was the most, I don't want to hear about like people's date they had last night. I don't know. It's just like, it was too personal to me.
The other thing with likes is it's great to get the likes. It's not the same thing as getting a laugh.
It's not. No. I mean, I use Twitter sort of as an open mic, definitely. Yeah. You know, I think I'll throw something out there and be like, cool, because a lot of my material has in the past been more storytelling-ish, and so Twitter's helped me write better, like, one-liners, so that's been good. But even, like, I was talking about this morning with my boyfriend. I was kind of in a bummed mood this week, and when I in a bum mood, I feel lonely. Like, you know, it's you feel lonely. And then I was on like Instagram and I saw photos of people that I'm not even close with hanging out. And I started feeling guilty. I was like, what's wrong with me that I didn't hang out with all my friends this week? And I was like, oh, I didn't because I was busy. And I also don't need to photograph every time I hang out with people. But it causes this at times, depending on your mental state, for me, an anxiety of like, I'm doing something wrong by not being like, hey, does that make any sense?
Yeah, because people post their narrative of their life as they want to present it to you. You don't post a picture of yourself lying in bed, paralyzed, unable to make
coffee. Well, it's interesting.
But people do.
And that's, I have a huge problem
with
people post.
Absolutely.
Oh, God.
Friend me.
But that's.
Whoever you are, friend me. I need you as a friend.
But that's also a weird narrative thing because there's also, like, I'm sorry, but if you're in the middle, I don't know about you, but when I've been having, like, a depressed moment or a panic attack or whatever, and I'm really crying hard, the last thing I'm thinking about is my phone. So yeah. When some asshole
posts, like, posts a video crying, of themselves crying.
And they're like, I'm so sad.
Really?
Shoot me. Yeah.
People do that?
Absolutely.
I can't stand it, and I can't stand the people that like it because I feel like they're enabling it. But at the same time, there's this new drug, and nobody knows what to take, and they're all like experimenting with it. And it's just.
I've never seen that.
I struggle between these things of like, I really try not. I don't take selfies. I don't post selfies. And every time I see somebody posting a selfie, I have this like conflicted reaction of just like, oh, Jesus, like this obsession with yourself. Mm-hmm. But then it's like, why am I so like self-conscious that I'm like, you know, I would never do that. It's like, what does that say about me of like, you know, am I not? Do you know what I mean?
I think it just like, goes back to being genuine, you know, because right. I think the same thing applies to comedy and applies to everything in life. Like, if you want to take a picture of yourself one day and post it, fine.
Right.
If you don't post anything for a week, fine. If you know, like, if you really are going, if you're really doing it from a place of, like, I want to share this, you know, but if you're doing it from that, like, place of, like, I need likes right now,
yeah.
I need attention, I feel like it sort of usually blows up in my face where, like, I get ignored.
This is interesting to me because, were you going to say something?
Yes. No, I was just going to say that
I want to interrupt you.
Absolutely. Something that you're very natural at.
Thank you.
I feel that there, you know, there is this degree of like, you know, you do see people who post these just extremely overly personal, overly things about things going on in their life. And there's a part of me that's like, yeah, it's almost this open forum for us all to be like, hey, like we all have a hard time. But at the same time, is it like, are you posting this to like help other people and to let people not feel so alone? Or are you posting this because you want people to call you and feel sorry for you and to like victimize yourself?
I think it's sometimes one or the other. Because I think,
yeah.
But I also think it depends on your, I think a lot of people, I don't want to tell people how they should or shouldn't use the internet, but it is an online portfolio in a sense, even if you're not a professional performer or writer. Like, this is a portfolio of who you are as a human.
Yeah.
So curate it. If you have like a really, you know, if you want to share something personal because you think it might help other people, awesome. I totally am a huge fan of that. But maybe make sure that your next post is like a little lighter. You know, like,
yeah.
It's, I don't know, there's just it's a consciousness thing. And so what I actually think has been, I hope, a good result of all the shit that's happening in politics in the country is I hope, at least for me, it made me step back and reexamine like what I can do to protect myself right now and take care of my own mental health and take care of
Jen,
you know, what?
Jen Sincero.
Yes. Yeah. Oh yeah. That book. You are.
What is this? Again, plug the
so
book.
Good.
I have to pick this up.
I have
up.
To read it. Cause I keep,
have you read it?
Yeah, I read it. Did you not read it yet?
I'm like 10 pages away from being
tell
done.
Me. You tell me about the book.
It's called You Are a Badass. And it's just like a good book about, I feel like the main.
This is what it looks like.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just like.
It's the best.
I mean, at its core, I feel like it's about being yourself and believing in yourself and not needing.
It's very, I will say, I remember when I picked up reading it, I went, oh, I'm wondering like what new ideas I was going to get from it. And to be fair, it's nothing that I haven't heard before, but it was put into a context and into a language that I could definitely relate to. And especially like, you know, I just turned 29. It's like the last year of my 20s or whatever. And it is, I remember doing those same exercises when I was in my early 20s and And I now understand why those might not have worked, because at my core, I was a different person. Mm-hmm. And now that I'm like almost 30, I'm like, oh, like I understand why those didn't work. I'm a totally different human being now, and I can apply these same things, and it
for
feels
example,
different.
For example.
What?
Give
for
me
example?
An example. Yeah.
Okay, so for one of those things is, you know, that she talks about, you know, that like you can kind of have the right intentions and like believe in yourself and write all the appropriate mantras down, but if you deep down have a core belief that it's not going to work, then it just won't. Mm. Because you truly yourself at your core believe it. And it's also just a reminder of like becoming, like I said earlier, like in meditation, just becoming aware of like the chatter in your brain of just like the things you tell yourself.
But that's what I think the internet can is neg because it adds more chatter.
Absolutely.
When there's already enough chatter. And so yeah. I'm not saying at all like these are the rules on how to use the internet or the internet's bad or it's the reason for everything. But I think with all things, there just needs to be more consciousness.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, our phones are something that like pull you out, can really pull you. So you have to use it with consciousness.
I want to share.
Right?
I'm not making a point. I just want to share this with you. I rarely have anxiety attacks.
You are white and male, so.
Right. And anxiety attacks come from a feeling of lack of power.
Mm-hmm. I know a lot of white guys who
like
have anxiety
I said,
attacks. So.
But I've dealt, I mean, I used to get anxiety mm-hmm. attacks. Now I give them. Trump's president, it's my country again. Mm-hmm. No, so in all seriousness, I've done a couple of digital detoxes lately. I know that sounds all goopy and
it's not
goopy. Wonderful. I love it.
Gwyneth Paltrow-ish. But I did a
I
couple
love that
of,
you know that.
I've done a couple of, by the way, speaking of goopy, I wonder how Dusty is.
Dusty.
There's a dog that's messing up Andrew Goldstein's apartment.
We're
right
hoping
now.
He pooped on the floor.
Yes. Okay, so last night I wanted to do a digital detox because I had done one the week before at the same time, and it was the night before this taping, so I could read and prep myself for the show and be really clear-headed. And I announced my digital detox, not on Facebook, but I texted people who I am in contact with, and I said, you won't be able to hear from me. I'm doing a digital detox for the next 5 minutes. So, no, I'm going to... You know, in the morning.
What time do we have to stay till Alex?
I'm going to, you know, I like to do a 12-hour. And I was expecting to have that Sabbath of reflection and blah, 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 blah. And I couldn't do it.
Felt anxious?
I for some reason, I felt alone, anxious. I started reading about Trump.
Mm, dangerous.
And couldn't find some, and I just had, and I had to go back on. And I kept, I literally said to myself, I went on Facebook, Twitter, checked my text.
I call it bar hopping.
And my email.
That's funny.
Come on, something make me happy. Light up my brain. Light up my brain.
Well, maybe it's a little, but maybe that's kind of, that's almost, okay, so detox, it's, you know, when you're dieting, for example, they say you shouldn't diet. You should just be a more conscious eater. As somebody, as a girl, who has dieted many times in my past, diets never worked. What worked was like finding balance. So maybe it's the same. I think it's the same thing with technology. So like for me, what I started doing about a year ago, per the advice of my friend Kelly, was in the morning, first hour that I'm awake, I don't use technology. So I wake up, I go to the bathroom, brush my teeth, I meditate. I try to meditate, do sort of like a meditation while making my coffee, my breakfast, maybe put on a Today Show. You know, I sort of do all the things. And then an hour after I've had a chance to wake up and like be alive for an hour.
You let yourself check your social media.
I do a quick check and then I start my day. And it has changed my life.
Say that again about, because somebody else told me to do that.
Yeah, I think I talked about it when I did another podcast I recorded here.
That not because we tend to wake up. My alarm clock is my phone.
Mm-hmm.
So I turn my alarm off. I'm holding my phone.
Put it down.
Yeah.
What do you need to, unless you, a car service is picking you up at 7 a.m. because you're, or whatever it is, right? Or flight. I can understand that. But there is nothing, if something's that urgent, it can wait an hour. Because if you don't want to have the extra hour to sleep or whatever it is, but you deserve an hour to set your brain. Because if you wake up and do the roll and scroll, which my boyfriend does, and I give him such a hard time about it, but it's his business if he doesn't want to be as enlightened as me. But no, I'm just kidding.
How is he with remembering to get coffee filters?
Feldman, drop it. We do a French press, but
not an issue.
It's not an issue. But no, to have that hour, because if you roll and scroll, you're starting, because what you do in the first 5 minutes that you're awake is going to set your day off. So, like, I just read I always say his name wrong, but Thich Nhat Hanh.
Who?
Thich Nhat Hanh. He's a Buddhist meditation teacher. It's
Thich Nhat Hanh?
Thich Nhat Hanh. I think I'm saying it wrong. Have you not heard of him?
It sounds like a porn
Don't
star I used
know.
To
know. Oh, come on.
Has everybody done that joke?
Your jokes are really lazy today, Feldman. I'm just going to be honest with you.
I know.
It's called The Miracle of Mindfulness? That's what it is. He says try to, in the first 5 minutes you wake up, smile. Because it's supposed to, like, change your mood for the day. Mm-hmm. But I feel like the same thing for me is true with the no technology and meditating.
Right. Hang on. As long as I'm being lazy, I...
Jesus Christ.
Let me see.
She's, like, saying real cool stuff.
No! I mean,
I was going to do a joke about it.
Go ahead. Do it. The floor is yours.
I wake up with a smile.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I...
That's... Good night.
Soil the bed. Yep. Okay.
Go ahead. I mean, hey, whatever it takes... That's wonderful.
Wait, I just, excuse me for one second. Did you know I was going to say that?
I did. Unfortunately.
Comedy is surprise.
Mm-hmm.
You figured he couldn't possibly do the soiling the sheets joke.
Sure.
So I surprised you by just what a horrible comic I am.
I've seen you sit down for an hour and write jokes, and they were either masturbating or poop jokes.
Half of those are like two really funny things.
Did I really?
I think I still have the doc.
Oh, because it was a Google Doc.
Yeah.
You were watching me.
Why were you watching him?
I had to. It was my job.
It wasn't your job to watch me.
I was organizing, so inadvertently reading them.
Everything I wrote was a masturbation poop joke?
Mm-hmm. To be fair, you were writing about Chris Christie.
All right. Okay.
And he wasn't masturbated to Chris Christie.
That's fair enough.
So you were saying...
I mean, I think I was done.
But about waking up with a smile on your face.
I mean, that's what the book said. I haven't tried it yet. But the other stuff, I just finished reading the book last week. But the book also, well, it's an older book, and it really relates. I really recommend everyone read it because it relates to today. It was talking a lot about, like, you know, people get overwhelmed with, I'm paraphrasing, but, you know, people get overwhelmed with, I get very overwhelmed with trying to change the world. And especially we're talking about, like, the going online and reading all the Trump news. I definitely went through those anxiety phases of, like, well,
activism fatigue.
I have to know what's going on, and I have to do something, and what am I going to do, and how am I going to do it? And, like, that, then you forget that, like, in your day to day, that's where you're going to make a big difference. Mm-hmm. So, like, by being a good person and a calm person and having that hour in the morning where you meditate and whatever, whatever, and then you go through the world, I'm going to be less likely to roll my eyes when someone bumps in front of me or call someone an asshole. Like, I'm very easily agitated, especially in the city. I know I'm coming across like, I mean, I carry a yoga mat, but it's really a prop. And I just to be like, look at me, you know, but and I use it to hit people to get in my way. But to me, being a nice person in the world is just as important in your day to day with the people around you, spending time with the people you love, asking them how they're doing rather than just tweeting at them is just as much, if not more important and useful activism than knowing what every headline is.
So social media is the myth of spirituality. The idea that you can be connected to everybody all at once is spiritual, but it's also hell.
I think with most things, it's balance. It's like saying that, you know, food is bad. It's like, well, you have to, food is also going to be really enjoyable.
But isn't the height of enlightenment feeling a sense of connection to everybody?
I don't know what the height of enlightenment is. I mean, I think it's being, walking through life. This is just, I guess, with a calmness and like radiating outward that calmness onto other people, calmness a sense. Yeah. There is a connectedness, but that's where empathy and compassion and all that good stuff comes from. And I think that the internet can be really useful at times too. I mean, I've heard podcasts that have like moved me. I've read articles that have moved me. I've had Twitter interactions with people who've been like, hey, I read this thing you wrote and it really helped. Like, I love those connections. I'm just talking about the connections where you're, when you're tweeting at an avatar of a frog and you're just like, blah, like, it's, that's not conscious.
Do you
that's
do
like,
that?
No.
Have you ever done it?
I have, and I've almost always immediately deleted it.
Deleted.
Like, I made a gun joke the day, it was the day that, what happened like a month or two? I can't even keep up anymore.
I remember that joke. That was like a month or two ago, wasn't it?
I don't know. It was like, I don't know if we're talking about the same thing, but it was 2 months ago. I said something on Twitter about guns, and it happened to be the day that there was a
shooting. Really? What are the odds?
It was a shooting by a, it wasn't an Islamic related thing. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? It was like,
I remember you did something not that long ago and it got like a fair amount of attention
I got a lot of threats.
Yeah, I remember
what do you mean
that vaguely.
Threats?
I had a lot of people. So basically,
let me hear the joke.
I honestly don't even remember.
I bet you I could find it. But
no,
I
deleted it.
I was gonna say
it wasn't even really a joke. It was just a statement about guns. I can't even remember what it was.
Anti-guns.
Right. I mean, anti non-gun control. I think I said yes. I am trying to take away your guns. Just right. Something smart, silly, mm-hmm. Not smart, intelligent, just dumb, right? And then an hour later, there was some kind of ISIS-related, like something that, it was that guy at the college campus, I think, wasn't it a couple months ago? There was
yeah,
a guy at
yeah,
a college
yeah.
campus. And so I tweeted while that was happening, but I didn't know the news story. So people, gun owners or gun enthusiasts, thought that I was
directly
relating it to that. And that's the problem with the internet too, is like, sorry, I didn't read all the headlines yet.
Mm-hmm.
So I went offline for a couple hours, not realizing that I had tweeted something
so controversial,
so relevant that day. And I come back and I have like, I don't know, like 50 people just being like, you want it? I have a gun. I'll show you my gun. Oh, really? You want to tell me that to my face and my gun? Just like, that's, you can't argue with a gun owner because they own a gun, you know? And I started to respond back. And then what I started to do is I started to respond back. Hey, I'm really sorry you feel that way. I hope you have a great day. Like, that's what, mm-hmm. that's how I'll try to respond. And then I just deleted the whole thing and went and didn't right. go online again that day. Cause I was like, this isn't even important to me.
And it's not real.
It's not even real. Cause I yeah. didn't even, I wasn't even, if I knew how to fix everything, I, no offense, wouldn't be sitting here. I would be, you know, the president.
You'd be on Mark Maron's show.
I know, but I mean, I'm just saying, I'm not very good at arguing policies and solutions because I don't really know them. I go from feelings, and that's not always the best way to argue. So that's my, I'm just trying
well,
to.
Well, actually it is. I'll get to that in a second. I have an article that I want to talk about. But well, I, as I understand it, I've been paying attention to Leslie Jones.
Uh-huh.
And Milo Yiannopoulos, the
mm-hmm. who I literally just figured out who he was like a week ago.
Oh, that guy is so dead. He gets a boner every time someone says his name.
Yeah. Okay. And he's a provocateur. So he tortured Leslie Jones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know about that. He set his army of Twitter followers on to.
For no reason.
Yes. Racism. Sickness. Right. Misogyny. From what I can tell, women experience Twitter far differently than a guy does.
The internet, I mean, life in general.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, I can't even, she has on top of it being a black woman. I can't even.
Can't relate.
Yeah. Like, but I could relate to I can relate to all of it because I understand pain.
So have you received horrible comments and tweets that.
Yes, and in private messages. I just got a message last week that was like,
I'm not that popular.
I wrote a joke that was like, DVoS is my birth control. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you want to talk about original jokes, the amount of people that tweeted, your face is your birth control. And I was like, I don't even understand how easy it is.
Somebody
for me
really
late.
Did that?
Somebody. Multiple guys.
Guys.
Guy, right. Mostly. I think a couple women too, which is also like, what? What are you even talking about? And then someone also wrote that on my Facebook page, and I just deleted it because clearly they noticed that I deleted it because they probably kept checking to see if there's a response. But then what was really nice is he sent me a message that said,
"Oh, you posted this, didn't you?"
Yeah, he said, "Just kidding, sweetie. Yeah, you're beautiful.
You're beautiful.
But
you're so
but
dumb.
Misguided.
But misguided.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I wrote. Yes.
Yeah. And
thank you for remembering.
Yeah. And his photo was because I checked his profile. His photo was a shirtless photo of him from like 40 years ago.
Sure.
So thank God he didn't really mean that I was ugly. But I am misguided though.
Misguided.
I am
beautiful.
Misguided. Yeah, but beautiful. But
beautiful
my
disaster.
Politics.
That's what she is.
Yeah,
that's her next album, Beautiful Disaster.
Yes.
All right. That's not. Well, yeah.
That's one of the most mild ones, but it's that like, hey, kiddo, let me tell you how it is, and I'm like, no, thank you. No, but I've had guys, you know,
I've had women. Do similar things, but like to my face.
Like what?
Like, for instance, last night I had, I bartend right now a few days a week, and I had a woman who was extremely unhappy with her experience in general. And she grabbed my arm, pulled me down to her level, and she goes, "I'm going to explain to you what hard work means." Like, to my face. And I had to sit there and listen to her because that's my job.
But I feel like that's like, a little, that's just someone being an asshole. I mean, I'm not to minimize it. I think what you're asking about is being on the internet as a woman.
Well, no, I want
to. But I think to be fair, that I was behind the bar with my counterpart, who is a Colombian male, who he was the person who actually extended the service to her. It wasn't even me. She said nothing to him.
Mm.
And it was my problem.
Hmm.
So it was, and I was the one who took all the heat from the manager, all the heat
from everything
else. The
Colombian male didn't do anything?
He pulled the manager aside later and was like, "I'm not sure why she's getting in trouble for something I did." Oh. But I found it.
Because if I had to deal with the Colombian male, I would have said, "What's the balloon of cocaine up your ass?"
Yeah, Sebastian's the best. But no, but it was, I found it interesting.
You're really funny on stage.
Swing and a miss, am I right?
Stage.
But, I'm so desperate.
You're going to take a crying video later.
My mind is just so
warped.
He's going
to do the video we hate. But I will say I was, and I genuinely didn't, I don't care what this woman thinks of me or whatever, but I did find it interesting that I was somehow to blame for all of it, even though I had done nothing.
There's an animal instinct at play there. I think when people perceive weakness, they kind of go for it. I think that woman, I don't think she was doing it because you were a woman. I just think she felt...
Sure, tread lightly.
I think she just felt that she was... Let me ask you about a guilty pleasure I have with certain women.
Scared.
Yeah, good night.
I have a visceral hatred for Kellyanne Conway.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Sure, like most people.
And Ivanka.
Yeah.
And I know that it taps into my lizard brain, the misogyny. I think all men have a certain degree of misogyny inside of them, the same way women have a certain degree of misogyny in them. That's a joke because I was going to say that women hate men.
She's got it. Yeah.
Okay. How much of my hatred, how much of our hatred for Kellyanne Conway is misogyny? If a guy was doing this, because when I'm being honest with myself, if a guy were doing this, would as much vitriol be directed at him?
Okay, so this is just a question. Obviously, I don't know the answer. But I wonder if it's because women tend to be a little bit, you know, I don't know, women smarter. Women aren't assholes as much as guys. And so when you see a woman like Kellyanne Conway just trying so hard. It feels like not, because to me, that's not powerful. What she's doing isn't powerful. To me, what she's doing is she's reading a post-it note that a guy handed her. And that's why she enrages me, because she seems like vapid and empty. And based on that stand-up video of hers that circulated,
God, that was awful.
You know, just like, I mean, so many of these people are just want attention. They want to be right. They want something. I don't know what is wrong with everyone and where, but for me, when I see someone like her, you're just like, but what do you actually think? Because I don't know that I believe her.
No.
Do you hate her?
I'm going to say something that you're going to probably be like, oh, roll your eyes to. But when I was in sixth grade, my friend's mom, I said, oh, I hate that ugly girl. And my friend's mom was like, don't say hate and don't say ugly, because those are very final. And those are very like the most evil thing. And I have a really hard time using either of those words.
Ever since she's been.
Really? No, I just, because I, this is going to sound, I mean, my heart, I hate calling it hate, because, I mean, yeah, if I see Kellyanne Conway, I feel a lot of rage, but I can't, I don't hate her because I'm
You don't hate.
I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I feel like I'm going to start crying. I just don't fucking understand these people.
Well,
I don't,
right. Well, okay, but
she's, it's
do
extreme.
You hate?
Do I, well, I mean, like, I will, the Giulia, again, no.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I think it's, I don't think that I hate, but yes, I would definitely, if I saw Kellyanne Conway, I would feel just, like, extreme, I would just, like, see red, like, I don't.
I feel rage when I feel injustice.
Yeah.
That's when I get mad. Like, when someone, like, the reason why I get mad at someone in the subway is because they're not getting up to give an elderly person their seat. You know what I mean? Like, that shit. Or,
yeah.
Like, you just were rude to my friend. Like, that's when I start, or, like, Kellyanne Conway and all these people, like, they're just being so unfair.
But it's not hatred.
She just confuses the shit out of
me.
She confuses the shit out of me because I just genuinely don't understand. I just don't understand what she wants. I don't understand what she's saying. I don't think she understands what she's saying. Just that sort of, like, when like, a reporter will come at her and just continue to question her and she just goes, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just like, you're right. You don't know.
And maybe this is sexist of me or what. I don't know. I'm sure somebody will get mad at what I'm about to say. But I guess I expect differently from mm-hmm. women because
yes.
I think about my parents' relationship, right? And my mom has always been the one to say to my father, like, okay, now calm down. You're being like, because, you know, there's women I feel like are often the voice of reason.
Yeah, I grew up my mother the same way. Calm down, you're choking me. Calm down.
You know, but there's and it's, you know, it goes back to how we're raised. Like, women are raised to be more in tune with their feelings. It's mm-hmm. it's, you know, it goes that way. It's not across the board. None of these are hard, fast rules, obviously. Uh-huh. So I don't know. You're just like, I don't know.
You expect men to, like, or especially, like, men in politics, for me, I expect them to be full of shit and to lie. Like, Sean Spicer doesn't surprise me. He doesn't make me mad. He's just, like, a dude.
Mm-hmm.
But Kellyanne Conway, it's like, you're like, you got to be kidding me. Like, how could you not stand up for, like, how do you not stand for anything? Like, I just don't understand.
You know, Trump, we're coming up on 5 weeks. Only one person so far has been brought before an ethics board. Kellyanne, for that little slip, go out and buy Ivanka's
for her promotion
stuff.
Of, yeah. Mm-hmm.
All the other stuff that's going on.
Totally fine.
But they went after Kellyanne. And I can't help but do a stutter step because I hate her. And my mother hates her. And my sister hates her. And other people I know hate her. And we get on the phone and it's.
I have a hate fest.
And Ivanka.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't help but wonder what that's about. Like, there's a huge part of me that wonders why my mother and sister hate Kellyanne so much. And I wonder if it comes from the same place where certain people have this blind rage for Hillary.
Yeah, maybe. I mean,
I feel like with Hillary, people were literally digging into weird, obscure bullshit from her past that was completely irrelevant to mm-hmm. the election, not even in the same world, like stuff that her husband did. Kellyanne Conway, we are pulling from actual, visceral, real things that are happening right now that are relevant.
Right. Has anybody done a sketch of Kellyanne Conway fighting with her husband, like an argument between the two?
I don't know, but that's a great idea.
Yeah.
That would be that's such a nightmare.
I mean,
That's not true.
I just think with, you know, even with Hillary, too, like, yeah, there are definitely people who don't like Hillary, don't like Kellyanne Conway, Ivanka, because they're misogynist. Sure, that's why they don't like whoever. But then there's people that don't like them because they don't like them. And mm-hmm. I think something over the test of time that is always, you know, we're talking about sweeping generalizations. I mean, that is a problem with a lot of stuff. Like, as annoyed as I get with super alt-right conservative people saying horrible things, I also get annoyed with some people on the other side of it who, you know, you can't say anything and there's all these terms and all these,
right.
Suddenly you're the bad guy, even, you know, like there's everyone I feel like
right.
is so full of feelings and a lot
so
of
many feelings,
so many feelings, so much misinformation, this disconnect, because a lot of it is happening online. I mean, the fact that almost every news story now refers back to Twitter. Trump said this on Twitter. A celebrity died. People are reacting on Twitter. Like, Twitter is everything.
Is
the news source.
Right.
And I don't know what the resolution is, but I just know that any significant change I've seen in people. So an example that I can give is, so my Italian immigrant parents, you know, dating outside my race, absolutely not. I mean, that was like a hell no growing up. I didn't even.
What is your race?
I mean, I guess white, a Caucasian, Italian. Okay. I don't know, but just like, you know,
it's a category. I
basically
guess
a black person. They're very black and white. My parents. So, you know, and then I never did. And my boyfriend currently is black. And now that I'm older, I sort of just trusted that it'll work itself out. And they were very scared and shared. No, not scared. Like. He's gonna like
no. I understand.
Just you know,
that,
but like this is new. I'm doing some. You know, I don't. And they accept. Everything's fine. But I don't think they would have understood that it's okay to be in an interracial relationship and go outside the norm unless the experience happened in our family. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
Like
that's a Republican viewpoint, by the way.
What?
That unless it happens to them, it's not important.
But that's what I'm saying. But yeah. I think that's the problem with a lot of people, like until you, I wish that there was a program, I don't know that it would work, where you could like have like a Muslim and a, you know, a this per like put people on like double dates or whatever, or meetups and have them just have a conversation. Because if you put a human to it, it just becomes more real. Like my dad who voted for Trump, which is like a whole other episode. You know, we've had some conversations about it, and I think he's a little brainwashed, to be quite honest, which is upsetting to see. But he was, you know, his whole thing is money. And he's like, why do other people get a free ride? And I had to work so hard to bring it back.
Nothing more dangerous than a self-made man.
Yep.
A genuinely self-made man.
He is genuinely self-made.
Nothing more dangerous.
Yeah, I'm so proud of him, but I don't know that he's proud of himself yet. And that, so he gets very protective of that. And then he was like, oh, you know, these people that get a free ride and da-da-da-da. My dad's a landlord. And I was like, yeah, but what about you've over the years have let so many people skip their rent here and there? Because he's had people who had a hard time. He goes, yeah, but I know them.
Oh, that's interesting.
You know what I mean? And so
there's
that. And then so when I brought that up when we were talking about politics, you saw him soften up and be like, oh, that's a good point. Like, so it has to be personal sometimes for you to change. And I don't know that the personal if things will happen on Twitter. Maybe they will. I don't know.
It's a lot to unpack. There's a lot to unpack. There's an article that I cut out, and I don't know who the author is. It's How to Win an Argument. It was written May 14th, 2014. I should hold off on this until I know the name of the author. This was sent to me, but the guy says that facts. By the way, I apologize to the author of this article. I think it was in Salon, but on next week's show, I'll give you credit. So I apologize. He said that in a political discussion with your father or anybody, you don't bring up facts. Forget facts. That's not how you win an argument.
Is that Tom Hanks?
No, it's Bill O'Reilly. He says,
upside down.
Give your opponent enough rope to hang himself. There's a phenomenon called the illusion of explanatory depth. That when you continue to question somebody as to why he believes that, eventually they will run out of steam and begin to see the fault in their reasoning, or their mind will open up. I've had this experience with conservatives where I just don't argue with them. I just keep questioning them, and then they get violent. Because eventually
they run out of
explanations. When you say to them, okay, I agree with you. Clinton was a horrible president. Barack is a horrible president. But what are we going to do about this? Then they get violent. Once they cannot tell me what they're against, once they have to tell me what they're for, they get violent. And then you realize, well, that's what they're for, violence. This is also interesting. Don't be a dick, he says. Diffuse disgust and change the frame. And this is really interesting. He said, there are five foundations to moral beliefs. There's, you question, you make a decision politically based on five foundations of moral beliefs. One, whether somebody is being hurt. Two, whether people are treating others fairly. Three, whether people are exhibiting loyalty to their group. Four, whether people are playing by the rules. And five, whether people are selling physical or spiritual things that are sacred. According to this theory, liberals only focus on care and harm, whether you're being hurtful, and whether or not people are treating others fairly. And that with conservatives, they're more concerned with whether people are playing by the rules and whether or not people are selling physical or spiritual things. And that's so when you argue a point, you have to address what conservatives care about. They care about whether people are exhibiting loyalty to their group, like America or a religion, and whether people are selling physical or spiritual things that are sacred. So if you want to appeal to a conservative, you have to throw out the facts and address those issues and argue based on that. I'll link to the article. Did that make any sense?
Yeah,
it does. Yeah, I just in general, I'm just so sick of hearing the words liberal and conservative. I'm like, is there anything, is there another category that you can be part of?
Or
you
see have one to... more Occupy Democrats article.
Yeah,
you don't hate.
Can you pick a team?
You don't hate. Doesn't hate feel good?
I mean, I don't mean to sound so whatever. I mean, maybe I'm sure maybe someone can prove me wrong.
What about after spending 45 minutes with David Feldman?
No.
No hate?
No.
Where are you performing next?
When does this come out?
This will be out Tuesday.
Oh, Tuesday night.
Yes.
I have a show called First Set at Union Hall, which actually would be great if you ever wanted to do it. It's comedians perform, and then afterwards we watch footage from one of the first times they ever performed while I interview them.
They didn't have video the first time I performed.
Yeah, but that's once a month. It's called First Set. It's at Union Hall in Brooklyn. And then April 14th, I'm doing my podcast. Hopefully we don't break up. We're doing a live version of it.
Tell me very quickly, let's plug your podcast.
Okay. And
you do
Kristen
everything.
Is producing the live show.
Oh, do you know Kristen?
I do.
Buckels?
Yeah.
Oh, good. I'm glad I got you two together. All right. See, I didn't write the recommendation, but I got you a job producing her podcast.
Okay. That's good night. Thank you.
I was supposed to do. Oh, wait a second. So what is the name of your podcast?
It's called Hopefully We Don't Break Up. And it's my boyfriend, comedian Will Miles, and I, we interview other couples and just talk about, you know, how you met, why do you stay together, all that good stuff, how to make
it
work.
Did you ever watch a couple break up?
On the podcast?
Yeah.
No. No. That's not the point. We're trying to break people up.
But that would be more entertaining, wouldn't it?
You know, I think we have a different
Feldman,
idea.
You forgot the coffee filters. Let it go.
Don't you think it would be more entertaining to bring a couple
I mean,
on?
Do you want me to give you notes on your podcast?
Yes.
Sure.
I mean... write better jokes.
That's
get
a good
your
note.
Author names.
That's a good
you
note.
Know. Don't be so hateful.
Write
Read
better
how to be
jokes.
A badass.
Yeah.
Okay. Kristen Buckels, plug some gigs.
No gigs to plug.
No gigs to plug. And what night is that?
Huh? No, that's the show you missed. Thank you so much for reminding me. No, I do have a brunch show coming up at Baby's All Right in March. I don't have the date yet, so.
Great. And how do people follow you on Twitter?
At Kristen Buck.
Okay. And yep. That's Kristen with a K.
Yep. And an E.
And Giulia Rossi, how do people follow you on Twitter?
It's Giulia Rossi, but it's with a G. So Giulia Rossi.
And stay away from you on Facebook.
No, you can be. You can like my page.
Okay.
Just don't try to teach me a lesson.
All right.
Not open to it.
That'll do it for us. Hey, I have a question to the listeners. Should we do a live Periscope? Would people be interested in doing this show?
Live. Periscope doesn't even exist.
Periscope exists.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think anyone uses it.
Well, people do.
People.
All right.
They're out there.
All right. Let me ask the listeners. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. There's a contact button. If we announced a time, would you tune in on Facebook or Periscope to watch me go down in flames?
With love.
Let me know. Thank you. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us. Thanks for listening to the show. Remember, we're not running ads. If you'd like to support this program for $5 a month, you can gain access to our premium content by going to davidfeldmanshow.com. Don't forget to do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. There's a contact button. Hit me. Hit my contact button. I answer all my emails. Thank you for listening. This Friday, Lewis Black. Pretty sure we have Lewis Black on our next show.